Thank you. Welcome to the June 1st Select Board meeting in the town of Deerfield here at the Town Hall in the Village of South Deerfield, 6:32 this evening. I'm going to call the meeting to order. The first item on the agenda is our minutes, but we do have someone here, so we'll skip down to public comment. And Kathy?
Just
so we don't keep you all night.
Kevin was going to be here, and
yes,
some of my questions would be answered, but
Doug actually has some information. He said
Doug has some information.
I do, and I spoke extensively. We actually spent a couple of hours, Kevin and I, talking about the concerns that. And you're Kathy, right?
Yes.
I got the name right. Okay.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
What's that?
You know where to send the tax bill, but you didn't send information for the
yes, that's
for town
different,
improvement.
Two different
not
offices.
The same mailing list, unfortunately. I addressed Kathy's concerns with the superintendent of public works, Kevin Scarborough, and I just put together a very, very brief report. We talked extensively about tree service and about the budget related to tree service, about what Kevin's plans were to address some of these concerns. There's two things that are happening. First, Kevin took a look at his budget. In his tree service line, he only has about $5,000 left, which translates to about 4 days of a crew from Jim's Tree Service or another company like that, basically it translates to that. And the reason we need a crew is in many cases, trees that need to be serviced have lines that go through them or immediately adjacent to them. So it's not just simply dropping a tree. It's actually going up carefully with a bucket, limbing it a piece at a time, dropping that down to another person on the ground who then runs the wood through a chipper. That being said, Kevin took a look at his salaries budget, and due to the very mild winter, he does have additional money in his overtime budget that was not used. What he's expecting to do is, with your approval, with the board's approval, to request a transfer from the salaries to the operations side of the highway budget, and he can make that transfer request through, with the board's consent, through the finance committee. He's hoping to move, I think he said, about $12,000.
Which is less than the 5%, right?
Far less than the 5%. I think the 5% is 14.9 or something like that. So
okay.
It's well within the realm of what's available.
Okay.
And I did check that with Brenda Hill as well, our town accountant, so we're good there. He's going to be asking for the transfer of money, which will enable him to do a number of, to take care of a number of trees. One big area of concern, and I don't think a lot of people walk on it, but it is a road that's very highly used. It's a road at the end of Pleasant Street on the west side of the tracks, where it cuts over and joins Conway Street. There's a line of evergreens there that have consistently shaded that road. And as a result of the snow and ice buildup, due to the sun not getting to it in the winter, as well as the sap and the pitch from the trees actually coming down, the road is in very rough shape as a result. For some years, there's been a request by the landowner right there to remove the trees. And Kevin is going to basically take some of the money that he's got, hire a service, and just have it done. He'll likely go with a service that has the ability to take the tree, essentially, as one piece and feed it into a chipper. He says it'll be 3, 4, 5 hours, and they'll be gone. And that road will be lighter, brighter, easier to maintain, safer in the winter because you're not going to have evergreen boughs falling under the weight of snow or ice, and the road will last longer as a result. But he is also going to be prioritizing a number of other trees that are on the list. He's working with, is it Brian?
Jason Miller.
Oh, Jason Miller. There you go. Thank you.
I did a lot of homework.
Oh, yes, you did. He's going to be working with Jason and basically saying, let's get going on these things. Let's prioritize this. My understanding is that he feels as though he hasn't had the time because Kevin's been down a person for the past few weeks. That being said, if it means hiring the crew, giving them what trees to take down and where, and letting them go and do the work independent of the highway department, then so be it. He is going to try to do some work. We talked about some of the trees up in Old Deerfield. We talked about the sidewalks in Old Deerfield. Kevin is aware of one area of sidewalk. It's at the very south end of Old Main Street where it turns east to head over to 5 and 10. He says that part of the sidewalk is definitely on his radar. It's a concern because apparently it's elevated above the road and it's starting to tilt down towards the road. So if you're not careful, if you're in a wheelchair or something like that and you're going along there and you're not careful, it's fairly unlevel. It's not just a couple bumps. It's right. Canted to one side. So he's focusing on that. He's trying to make some decisions as to what he can do to make those repairs sooner rather than later. We talked about the other sidewalks in Old Deerfield. The biggest concerns are the fact that the old growth trees, the roots. I asked, what can we do? Can we just resurface? He said, absolutely. And you'll have the same problem in about 2 years.
But also, you can't resurface because, you have to really be careful not to compact the roots.
Right.
I mean, one of the
you
problems when
trees.
Bement yep. pick up those tree roots are getting compressed, and
right.
you know those trees are going to be dead in a while.
Right.
But those trees have all been replaced because
yes,
the street was lined with elm, and elms have all been replaced. And
sure, sure.
That tree, the tree line is the trees on both sides have now canopied over mm-hmm. like the elms did.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
they've been there for quite a while. But
4 years or so?
My concern when I asked the question about especially Old Deerfield was not so much the south end, but the north end.
Mm-hmm.
There's literally a portion of the sidewalk missing. It's on the west side of the north end.
Okay.
And I saw that the town did an excellent job building an island around the town common. They did it with asphalt. They have all kinds of equipment now. They've got rollers, everything else. I just can't understand. And it's been years. It hasn't even been.
Was the island built by the town?
They were there working on it.
Was it the town or was it the state?
I have no idea, but the town was there. I don't know who ended up doing the work.
Okay.
But I did read, believe me, I went through a lot of town reports. Read a lot of Milt Williams reports. And in one of the reports, his report to the town was that the town has taken over the trees on Sugarloaf Street, because I know you had mentioned that
yep.
116, but the town has now taken over the the tree work on Sugarloaf.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever reason, I don't know, but that was just mentioned in one of the reports.
Well, do you remember what year that was, Kathy?
I do.
That would be very helpful.
Maybe I have it written down. Let's see.
And who made the report?
Milt
made the report?
Milt Williams.
Let's
he was the old tree ward.
From how long was he from?
He was like 30 or 40 years.
Let's see. He from 1954 to 2008 or 9. He was the tree warden in town.
And the town took over management of the trees on Sugarloaf Street?
No. Somewhere along, I just looked through my notes a little more closely here. And I have the years that I looked up so I can tell you, go back and look. And he actually did a tree survey in 1985. And he said in the village of South Old and East Deerfield. And he also said that the value of those trees was over $2 million at that time, which I thought was interesting.
The value of the trees?
Yes. You try to replace some of those trees. Yeah. And then after Milt was, he retired, it was still an elected position, and Henry Cocut took it over. And the salary jumped from $400 to $1,000. And I did look in the 2010.
We didn't. That was because we didn't offer insurance.
Right.
We stopped offering insurance.
But in 2013, Sean gave it over to Jason Miller.
Delegated Jason Miller as a lead on the
We cut the $1,000 out of the budget.
Well, it was still in the budget. Let's put it that way. So I'm just telling you what I took from the.
Yeah.
Whatever the town reports were, and
those are the years that we almost didn't make the budgets.
Yeah, but it's been pretty well consistent about the how much money's been spent, except for 1 year there was Hurricane Sandy and it really went up. But I have a question for you. What is WWTP?
Wastewater Treatment Plant.
wastewater treatment. Okay, it just appears everywhere, and it's like, I have no clue what it is, because you combined a lot of your budgets into public safety, and then under those is the Public Works and the Police Department somewhere along the way.
The wastewater treatment is under,
right,
the highway.
Right, but I mean, you had to go hunt for the highway department's information, because at some point it got combined under public safety, and...
Yeah, no.
Oh, go back and look, you'll see it.
Okay.
I mean, that's the way it's reported. Whether that's the way it is.
Highway is combined with public safety?
Yes. I'll bring it in, I'll show you. But that's not the point. So, you know, some years there was 94 trees, 48 trees, 52 trees, and, you know, he mentioned in his reports that, that, you know, it was getting more and more expensive to take down trees and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a tree on the north end of South Deerfield, on North Main Street, that has been dead for several years. And I've looked very closely. The power lines are maybe 20 to 30 feet away. So it's not...
What else is near that tree? What else is near the tree?
Is it
houses.
And where is the tree?
Is it in the town?
Yes, it's in South Deerfield on North Main Street.
Right, but
on the east side.
Is it on the our
yes.
Right away?
Yes, yes. So I appreciate it, but how did he address the Oxford site?
Yes. Well, I wanted to finish adding the rest of the information. So he is still working with Jason to prioritize what trees they can address. He's looking again to hire companies before the end of this year. His budget for next year was increased by the select board, and that increase was, for the most part, held over by the finance committee and approved by town meeting. I asked if he could apply that money as well to tree work in the summer, and he said that he has to pace that out so that he has money in tree work reserve for the winter, which is when he sees a lot of damage to trees and a lot of work that needs to be done. So he's going to do as much as he can with the money he has this spring to try to finish up this work as best as he can. He'll continue to do some work over the early part of the summer once we turn the corner onto the next fiscal year budget.
This is what's left over in 2016.
He has about $5,000 left over for 2016. We're going to transfer about $12,000 over from his overtime budget for a total of about $19,000. About six or seven of that is going to take care of the west side of the tracks. I don't even know the name of that cross street, but it's the end of Pleasant Street. And then he's going to work with Jason to prioritize the rest of what he can with the money that he has. He's further working with the council and governments to conduct a so-called tree survey. A specialist will be coming down to identify specific trees and to help prioritize which trees can easily be removed, which trees require a tree service, and so on and so forth. That's something that he's doing at no cost to the town, and I think he's doing that tomorrow.
But doesn't Eversource go through? They've marked a bunch of trees already in town.
And if Eversource goes through and marks trees, it means that they feel that they need to limb trees right. In order to avoid wires. But there's a tree down at the end of Sugarloaf towards 116, which looks like a giant Y. Mm-hmm. And that's what you get when Eversource goes through. They only take away the tree
mm-hmm.
limbs
I know.
That are going to interfere with their wires. So there is that. We talked a little bit about sidewalks. And actually something we mentioned earlier today, I was talking with Trevor earlier this afternoon about looking at the South Deerfield area and trying to resurrect some of the plans that were put together on the most recent streetscape studies. And those studies actually would impact all of the walking areas from the railroad tracks to Thayer Street, from Thayer Street on Main Street, all the way up to Frontier Regional, in terms of improving the condition and the quality of the sidewalks, and more to the point, improving the walkability right around the town common and the four-way intersection there. We did talk about, again, the sidewalks up on up in Old Deerfield on Main Street. I will have him once again take a look at the north, and you said it's the west side or the east side? The west side.
Northwest side.
Northwest side of Old Main Street, and give me some information on that. He did say that on the east side, for the most part, I think it's Bement School that's taking care of the sidewalks. They proactively paved a sidewalk, and they're maintaining it in the winter as
Deerfield
well.
Deerfield Academy has too.
Deerfield Academy is taking care of a lot of the walks, yes, mm-hmm. especially on, I think it's called Old Albany Road.
There's no sidewalks on Old Albany Road.
Okay, there you go.
But there are sidewalks in front of some of their homes that when they do them over, they repair them.
Kathy, the sidewalk that was missing, was it never there, or is it just kind of
I have
just
no idea. I
disappeared or
like I said, it got washed away in Irene.
Oh, okay.
No. It's been gone more than that.
That section
2008
got wiped out, though, but that's where the water came through, Kathy. So whatever was there got worse.
2008 is now what, 2016, and the sidewalk hasn't been replaced?
Well, it was 2011, and...
Well, 2011, so it's still 5 years. And that's my point. And it's not a big section. It's probably not even half the size of this table.
So in order to understand fully why that didn't happen, we would need to go back and talk with Hap. We would then need to talk with Sean and find out why they chose not to prioritize that as well. I understand the need to get this work done, and I understand the need to prioritize this. Kevin's been doing the job he's been doing loosely for about a year and a half. Mm-hmm. And it's great that we have folks that are looking and helping to bring information to us. There's a certain scope to what Kevin can do. Excuse me. That being said, I will, again, have him take a look at North Main Street, and we'll see what we can do. I spoke extensively with Kevin about the highway yard, the materials yard, and with the Oxford property. We talked about the Oxford property first and foremost. He understands and recognizes that there's still material there. He's going to prioritize moving that hopefully within a week's time. Anything that's old scrap metal, they're going to lift up, load up, and put it into a truck to be hauled away to Kramer's. Anything that's still useful, he's going to find a place for it around or behind the new highway garage, get it stacked, put away neatly as best as possible.
Not much room there, excuse me. I rode around it twice this weekend, and I took pictures. There's not a lot of room back there.
Around the back of the highway, yes. Fair enough, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yes. This is also one of the reasons why we held on to the red barn on the Oxford lot, is because we need additional storage space.
A $6 million garage and you need additional storage space?
The $6 million garage is a scaled-down version of what was originally requested. There were supposed to be at least one, if not two, additional equipment sheds.
I'm sorry. That's a lot of money that we spent there that should have taken everything into consideration and what we got. And I'm not saying it's not worth it and we didn't need it. I agree 100% we did need it. But the thing is, I'm just concerned about the Oxford site. Going through the town reports and you see all this money being spent on this committee, that committee, and everything else to promote the Oxford site. And we're the biggest offenders, the town. And I mean, the pitted sidewalk. I mean, I took pictures. I mean, it's there.
I had two separate individuals look at that sidewalk. Neither one, Kevin did see one chip in one location.
Oh my
gosh. He says the sidewalk is wearing normally.
How old is that sidewalk?
2 years, to the best of my knowledge,
years.
3 years?
The day after our last meeting, I deliberately went there to look at it, and I walked all the way, and there's two pot marks.
Yes, but you go closer to the garage. There's a lot of pitting in the cement.
Yeah, that was that way when it was probably made.
That's right. That's the point. It was that way when it was made, and it's only going to get worse.
What causes that type of thing? When you screed concrete, you get air bubbles in it, and if you don't go over it time and time again, those air bubbles stay right underneath the surface, and in a short amount of time they pop, and that's where you see all this little pitting. It's usually happens because concrete dries too quickly. So I don't even know when they did it, but I'm going to assume they did it during a hot day. And a lot of times when you see concrete poured, people will put burlap bags over the concrete and wet it because they want it to dry slowly, and that prevents that type of thing. But I did see two other marks in the sidewalk that were about that big around. And here again, it could have been just the way the concrete was and it popped. It shouldn't have happened, but it did.
It did.
I didn't see any that were not level or
anything.
Oh,
gosh, no, I never said that. I just said the pitting was a concern because I don't want it to end up like the rest of the sidewalks.
Yeah, I think that concrete, from what I see of it, is it will last quite some time. It might not, every pad might not be as pretty as the others, but
right.
The only way that those two bigger holes actually go down about 3/4 inch, somebody could trip on it, but
somebody had a pin put in one of them. There was a marker type of thing was in one of them, and I'm assuming that's what caused that one big hole.
I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, both the ones I looked at, it looked like they had just popped, and it was probably because of the way it was finished. But,
mm-hmm. But still, that doesn't address everything. But there was a beautiful fox out there the day I went and took pictures, crossing across the lot, and I did get pictures of the fox. So, but it doesn't address the looks of the lot and the dumping ground. And we've been in business for a long time. We've had people come in and clean up our yard. All the metal and everything else. They take it away for a fee, they give you back some of the money, and it doesn't have to come out of the town's pocket and the town will, from time-wise and everything else. There are scrap metal places. I mean, there's so much that can be done that can share in this cost, and the town can still benefit.
Can't do it, Kathy.
Excuse me?
We can't do it that way. It's not against the procurement.
After what?
We are not allowed to do that for procurement reasons. So
how are you allowed to do it then?
We have to use our town people, or we can do a proposal, request for a proposal, but we can't just have someone come in.
Okay,
and do
fine.
It.
Do you do it for?
We've been under staff for for 2 or 3 years, so you know, I'm not saying that it's not legitimate, and we're going to address it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would like to see some effort put into making it look pretty, too. But I have to say, in Kevin's defense and in defense of, you know, our transition of staff, we've been down, you know, 2 or 3 people constantly for the last 2 or 3 years.
And why is that?
Because people left.
I understand why they left, but do you ever ask the question, why are they leaving? What's going on?
Well, Sean left, and they're getting higher paid jobs elsewhere, basically. Mm-hmm. At least that's what I understand the people have left. So we've constantly been down in staff, and we haven't had much extra money. So any extra stuff, you know, fortunately this winter was not so bad, so we have a little extra money we can transfer, mm-hmm. and, you know, we'll address some of your concerns.
I'm not for the town going out and spending money, but preventive maintenance is a lot better than having to go. And it doesn't take a lot of money to be preventative. It just takes time, and I don't know what the answer is. I'm not here on the day-to-day stuff, but I just reporting on what I see around town, and it's just very upsetting. And like I said, pay a lot of taxes, and to see nothing done is very frustrating.
Well,
about these issues, I'm not saying about everything else. I'm talking
well,
about these issues.
Unfortunately, we've had to prioritize, and you know, so Kevin is addressing some of this stuff.
Okay, and like I said, I'm willing to talk to Kevin. And listen to what he has to say. I'm not here to.
We're not making excuses. We're listening. Kevin's addressing
totally
it.
And
but I'm just saying, in defense of Kevin, and he works extremely hard, and we've just been down in staff.
Mm-hmm.
We've had turnover in staff, and you know, and he's been down sometimes two or three people.
But so. I do know they've hired.
What?
I do know they've hired, and they
yes.
Do they do any more hiring for the summer?
We did authorize some summer staff.
That was not budgeted.
Oh, we didn't budget it? We ended up
budgeted.
Not budgeting? Okay.
There was discussion about summer part-time staff. There was discussion about hiring contractors to do things like lawn mowing, cemetery maintenance, that kind of thing, and we're still looking into that, but there's no budget for it. Next year, possibly.
Okay. Well, we have discussed it. Kevin's down one person. He's down as a facilities person right now.
He's actually down two people. He's had one person out on long-term injury for about the past month.
Okay.
I don't remember who that is, but he's supposed to be coming back on limited duty, I think this week, maybe last week.
So
he was out for a good month and a half.
We've just had, and we've had extreme events on a regular basis, so there's been culvert repair, road repair, constant road repair. You know, so
there's
would
no
I like
Chapter 90
would I
funds
like,
available?
What?
Chapter 90 funds available?
Chapter 90 funds, we have been using Chapter 90
I
funds,
know.
But,
see,
but
it
we
is,
have
but I'm
to,
just saying
but we have to still use our staff people, and you know, we have 14 cemeteries to take care of and get ready for Memorial Day. So I mean, I'm not making excuses, but I'm just saying there are reasonable things that are happening.
And I'm not saying they're not reasonable
yeah.
excuses. But
so,
I am
and
just
we will address it,
said,
Kathy.
As you see a more active community and people getting out there, I'm thinking there's a lot more people out there who are thinking the same thing I'm saying, who just haven't showed up at these meetings and pay taxes and everything else in this town. And, you know, these are things people like to see. I know there's things that happen. I've served on I don't know how many committees in this town. School committees, Frontier, have done budget negotiations, ag committees, planning committees, you name it. I've put my time in this town, too. So it's...
And I appreciate that.
I'm not looking for appreciation. I'm just looking to tell you that I'm not just here on a whim. I'm here on a person who's brought up in this town, lived all my life here, and concerned about what's happening.
Well, I have to say that, you know, we were trying to let the department head, and Kevin has done a good job prioritizing what absolutely has to get done. As you know, years ago, the highway department would pick up dead animals in the road and let other work slide mm-hmm. because of what people perceived as a priority. But
I do know as a highway department, too, and I don't know if this happens now, that my uncle actually worked for the highway department, that, you know, they take their lunch out and they eat their lunch wherever they're working. I don't know if that happens now. You know, I just know that this town is very spread out and it's a long ways back and forth. You know, I can say I have no clue that what happens and how that does, but I just, like I said, I've had an uncle work on the highway department for years, and that was, you know, he took a piece of equipment out, did his work, brought his lunch. There's people working next door to me. I brought lunch out in the field today. I mean, and I know there's contracts. I know people need their time and everything else. And, but.
Well, our people work extremely hard, and we are prioritizing what needs to get done, and we will look into this some more. Okay?
Okay. And I just want to know how Doug made out on his letter he sent out. I would rather spend $200 and donate to buy a tree or two to plant in this town than to do a planter and have it only one season and that's it.
We've received some good responses in regard to that. We are still looking to determine a finalized plan as to what's going to happen with it. I have been hands-off on that project that's being principally driven by Sue Corey and...
That's Yankee Candle.
Oh my goodness, our senior center director. Marlene? No, yes, did I get the name right? Oh my goodness. Brain fart, I apologize. But Marlene and Sue have been driving that project for the most part. The volunteers from Yankee Candle will show up on the day to do whatever work needs to be done. But they're doing the coordination. Sue is still trying to determine how much money we're expecting and what we can do with it. I'll make the recommendation to her, but I would also strongly urge you to stop by the Senior Center. They might be there tomorrow, but I know they'll be there Friday. And offer suggestions, offer advice, because those are good ideas.
Oh, I know the Senior Center. I've gone by and looked at that, too, after I read your letter and everything else, looked
sure.
at all the places.
Yep, definitely worth taking a look at, but talking with Sue and seeing what they have planned. I think that would be a really great idea.
Yeah, like I said, I don't think the idea is bad. It's the problem is maintenance, and is another thing that
absolutely.
Shouldn't have to
absolutely.
Fall on the town department because... After listening,
it won't. I did bring that up with Sue. She responded by saying basically she doesn't know about that. She hasn't determined the long range plan because the short range plan is to get materials and money and then to see what we have available. Once we get closer to the date, she's going to help work to refine a plan. So there's that. I do know that Marlene's been in touch with Diane Gripko from the South Deerfield Women's Club in regard to the Common, and they're talking about what's possible there. So I'm glad that communication is happening.
And you can participate in the you know, this winter when we have the Finance Committee meetings, because I'm sure Kevin, under our direction, will put in again for, you know, the correct amount of money to address the tree problem. And so you need to come and talk to the Finance Committee, because the Finance Committee does not believe that it is a worthwhile expense.
Mm-hmm. But the other question, like, I looked at the schedule for tonight's meeting because I just assumed it would be at 7, and it was 6:30. But it says it in one place, but it's not on the town calendar. There's no selectmen's meeting tonight. On the literally calendar.
You kind of go to open, was it open? Public?
Public events.
Public events.
Select board, 6:30.
No, but there's an actual calendar?
Yeah, it doesn't get used for some reason.
And it just didn't have, it had everybody else's, like on Monday, it has all the stuff, and.
But there's an actual calendar?
There was an actual calendar there.
We've got a public events calendar?
I don't know what that was, on the left, under, but I did look at the website.
On the left on the website, there's About Deerfield, and right below it is Public Events.
Yes,
and that's,
I saw that.
That's the one that has apparently the meetings.
Yep, that's our active calendar.
Right, there
calendar.
Is another calendar that doesn't show much.
There is another calendar.
I thought we got rid of
literally calendar. Like a sheet.
Yes.
And it doesn't show it.
Correct.
So that's, I was trying to track down the time of the meeting tonight, and
we
ended up going to the public events, what you're saying, Trevor, and
right.
Finding it there.
Yes. It took me a while to find it as well. But
but it has all the standard meetings, well, which, I don't know what your schedule is. So
our board meetings are usually every other Wednesday, right? 6:30.
Yeah, I know they're always Wednesdays, but.
Yeah, every other.
Sometimes we have off Wednesdays. But it's every other Wednesday, usually.
Every other Wednesday, twice a month.
Although we're going to meet the 28th, I believe, instead of the 29th this month, because we have meetings, other meetings on the 29th.
Okay. Tuesday the 28th. Okay.
Trevor has a collaborative, and that's also the annual meeting for the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition.
On the 29th.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think you can actually go to both.
Yeah?
Yeah, because it's early enough. You can.
Oh, good.
You can go to the one
yes,
first.
Yes, one's at 5, right?
Yeah.
Yes,
or
great.
Or 4:30. We might have it at 4:30.
Well, that'd be great.
Yeah.
And then I'll shoot down.
I will. I'm trying to get it early, a little bit early.
Perfect.
Thank you for coming in, Kathy.
Thank you very much
You'll
for your
info.
You'll
see me again, I'm sure.
Oh, good.
Great. Just to pass on to Kevin, I had actually, well, not really a complaint, but just a concern that the way we mow, the knotweed gets spread, especially along River Road. So I was going to contact, and I just haven't had a chance.
Way we mow?
Mow the roadsides for knotweed.
Where do we do that?
Along River Road. There's quite a lot of knotweed.
Okay.
And so the way you cut it, it you know, comes in chunks, and that's how it propagates. It can propagate.
What's
that
your
way.
Suggestion?
I don't know, and the person that complained didn't really have a idea either. So I was going to, and I haven't had time. That's why I wanted to make sure it was clear that I was going to talk to a couple of our groups that are in our resilient communities group that we have, like the American Rivers, and see if they have a suggested cutting method. And there's a few groups that might be able to help us come up with a better way to address the knotweed. We could do skip the knotweed and do some other alternative cutting method.
The
or ratification, because the only way you can get rid of knotweed is it's a rhizome kind of thing, so you have to physically dig it up, and
that's the only way to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Is to actually pull it up by hand, roots and all, and then to continue to treat the area for at least 2 years after that.
And
the only way my father has been able to treat is by literally mowing it down and mowing it every one or two weeks. And he did that for 2 years, and it's still coming back. So you're absolutely right. The only way to get rid of it is literally to uproot it, which probably means removing the loam entirely. And if we're talking about doing that along an entire roadside, now you're talking about...
I know. I'm just telling you that I did get a concern, and I said I would look into it, and I need to just do some investigation and see if there's any way we can get some help or some guidance or something.
Okay.
But I just didn't want to forget about it. Since we were on highway issues, poor Kevin would probably having a heart attack.
I do want to finish up the final bits of information I have from what I spoke with Kevin about the condition of the Oxford property. He's certainly going to be making that a priority, again, removing the scrap steel, moving the shelving, which is donated to the town that's on that property. He's going to be moving that back onto the highway yard. There should be room for that. There are some old tools, implements that are no longer in use that will be scrapped. He's going to be, as quickly as possible, they're going to be focusing on not mowing, grooming, but at least knocking down the brush and the overgrowth on that property. There is an 18-wheel tractor that's privately owned that's parked on town-owned land that I believe is we're asking the owner to remove it. It's been there for quite a while. And there is gravel that is being stored in the depression area. I think it used to be a loading dock for the Oxford company when it was there. There is sand and gravel that's being stored there, but it's almost at ground level. In the southwest corner, there is old material, basically crushed concrete block from the old highway garage. I asked Kevin about that. I said, can we move it? Can we get rid of it? He said it's actually valuable as fill material. As they continue to do work on roads, replacing culverts, it is legal and appropriate to use crushed concrete block, if it's crushed down small enough, as backfill, as stabilization, yeah, instead of having to go out and buy new material. It's possible to scoop that all up and move it, say, to the north side of the transfer station. But again, that's a guy with a payloader, a guy with a truck, and a couple of days worth of work. I asked
if it
could be...
We'll probably use it through the summer.
It's very likely. He also advised that there will be a great deal more material going onto that particular site as North Main Street gets milled and resurfaced in June. If you want him to not pile more material there, now's the time to mention it. And it is possible, perhaps, to move that material up to the transfer station instead. But I haven't spoken with Kevin about that possibility. However, I'm happy to, and we can discuss
Are we taking the milled material as part of the contract? Is that reducing the price of the contract?
We're taking the milled material, and it's valuable to us as, again, as a material for future use. So
we'll have we should have a discussion with Kevin on that then, maybe.
Okay. I would... Would you like him to be at the next meeting? I mean, that's 2 weeks from now, but...
No, I think what we wanted to do was have department heads come on a regular basis.
Sure.
And since Kevin couldn't come tonight, just at some point, schedule John and Kevin and Barbara and Zach's here tonight. Maybe Zach can do a little report and just have him come on a regular basis so that we can have an update on what's happening and what they foresee is going on. I think it would be very helpful both to Kippy and Trevor, since they're relatively new, but that way we can ask questions and make sure that they're okay with the budget. We'll have the printouts from the budgets pretty soon. We have end of the month fairly soon, and we'll see where we are, what's left over. If there's anything that we want, to prioritize and do a small transfer, I think it's worth it before the money goes back to free cash.
If we're going to do transfers, I do know a finance committee meeting is scheduled for June 21st.
Okay.
There's a number of transfers / reserve fund transfers that will need to happen already. Legal services is overspent and will be overspent by probably $7,000 or $8,000. ZBA is overspent, and there are a number of other accounts which are overspent by a small amount. Some of these were accounts that have never been funded in the past, but additional expenses unexpected came about. So we will be doing a number of reserve fund transfers. I'm hoping to take care of as much as I can ahead of time by just transferring within the budget, within the department, or from one department's budget to another one. Nothing is terrible, nothing is crazy, nothing is off the wall, but there are a number of things that we'll have to take care of.
Okay.
If you're looking to have departments do extra work, there's going to be very, very little time.
I know.
In order to fund it direct the department head to do that work and then to accomplish it before June 30th.
I know.
If we start a project, we can encumber funds to the next fiscal year.
I know. But it just, you know, we're getting towards the end of the budget year, so we'll have an idea of what, you know, our actual expenses are. You know, sort of like the overtime budget from from a mild winter kind of thing. You know, if we're seeing some of that happen. You know, it's been hot weather. There's been an awful lot of usage at Stillwater. The chief might need some extra money for Stillwater. We need to discuss that. Just make sure he has enough to cover that.
He will have plenty.
Okay.
For the month of June.
Okay.
He's got plenty.
All right. Yep. It's looking pretty hot. All right.
Yep.
Zach, I know you're here, sweetie. Why don't you come up? I'm sorry to keep you waiting.
EMS agency, and I'm here on some business, but first I can give you a brief director's report.
Wonderful. That would be wonderful.
And if there's anything that people know about me, it's how short I like to talk. That's a joke, I don't. So I think the biggest news, and actually it's been a long day for me, this morning the State of Massachusetts Office of Emergency Medical Services, as part of our annual renewal process, came and inspected us. And we passed with flying colors, and part of the reason why...
Wonderful.
Yeah, so great. Totally expected. I mean, that's the normal thing, is you pass and you keep operating. But one of the things that really stood us out was that we've implemented this really comprehensive education and training program for all of our staff. So we have 8 full-time staff members that staff our primary paramedic truck 24/7, but we also have that contingent group of... local EMTs and responders that were with Deerfield EMS and Whately and Sunderland Fire previously. So we've adopted all these people into the larger organization, and it's been a real challenge trying to keep them trained and up to date, especially now that we're operating at the paramedic level. So working with our partners in our education and training, Matt Wolkenbright up at Community 911 Training in Greenfield, we've got this new mentor program, this training program, and everybody from all the way at the top to all the way at the bottom is going through this program, and it's kind of a way for us to make sure that we're meeting our obligations as a department to make sure everybody's trained and educated and feels comfortable. And we're finding that there's a lot of people that, myself included, thought was comfortable, and then it's like, oh wait, there's this thing, it's this rare thing that we do, but how do we do that again? So that's been hugely beneficial and successful, and it's helping us kind of bring everybody together as a more cohesive department. One of the reasons why this is so necessary is that we're getting busier. So May was actually our busiest month to date this year, and we're seeing that trend go up. Law of averages in emergency services, sometimes we're low, sometimes we're high, but we're definitely increasing. And a lot of what's happening is we're getting simultaneous calls as well. So the core of our department is one paramedic truck 24/7. So you call 911 and that truck is available, if they aren't already on a call. And we're getting more and more simultaneous calls. So that second call that's coming in 10 minutes after the first. And in order to deal with those multiple calls, we've redirected some of our funds to help add personnel during the day. So we're calling it an impact shift. It's 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. And statistically, that's when we see the majority of our calls in EMS. That's when people are driving around and they're crashing their cars. That's when they're at work. That's when they're at play, recreation, and things like that. So we've added staff, and because of that adding staff, the reallocation of the funds, we've actually been able to respond to these calls. And one highlight recently, highlight for the department in our response, probably not for the individuals, but there was a car accident in Whately, 3 people, two critical from that accident. We were actually to respond in the middle of the day with 3 ambulances, 2 at the paramedic level, and we transported all 3 people in South County EMS trucks, 1 by helicopter, 1 by ground to Springfield, another 1 by ground to Cooley, and that's something that we never would have been able to do in the past. And not only would we not have been able to do that, but it actually would have taxed our greater EMS system as a whole, because we would respond at the basic level and still needed another paramedic truck to come in. So we were able to provide those services immediately.
Wow,
so
that's great.
A huge kind of check mark for our department and what we're capable of. It still means that sometimes we get simultaneous calls. You know, we only have a finite number of resources, and when that happens, we dispatch mutual aid just like any other community would immediately. So we're making all of our calls that we can, and we're doing good stuff. So that's great. Also, that impact shift, what that also allows us to do is having that extra crew on during the day means that we have that additional ambulance and resource to not only provide coverage for Deerfield, Sunderland, Waitley, but also now do intercepts and back up our other communities. So we just signed a intercept agreement with Medcare Emergency Health in Greenfield, who are seeing their own staffing difficulties. And what that means is they can respond at the basic level, and it's almost a reversal of history. They respond at the basic level, and now they call us to respond and provide paramedic services. So not only are we providing greater service to our larger community, that actually is a revenue stream as well for us to help recoup the costs of that additional staffing. Also, that additional staffing allows us to do more standbys. And just recently, Deerfield Academy has hired us for their commencement weekend. Typically, in the past, they would have hired one of the private ambulance companies, but they prefer to deal with us. We know them, we interact with them on a regular basis, and they're more comfortable with us. So this past year, because we have this additional staffing now, we have that increased revenue of being able to be up there and interact with them. And that's been a huge benefit. Wow, so much great stuff going on. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the RFP for housing, which closes this Friday, June 3rd at 2 in the afternoon. Yeah. So that's been in the news, right? We need a home.
Yes.
We need a home, and the RFP has gone out to kind of outline what we're looking for. So if anybody's still interested in responding to that. And kind of speaking about letting things known, a major outreach program that we're trying to kind of capture everybody in multiple different avenues. So FCAT, which I'm talking on right now, has been a huge benefit to us. They actually produced a series about South County EMS. What do we do? They have little vignettes. Those are all available on their website or on their YouTube stream. I can't speak for, I think it's FCAT.tv
FCAT.tv.
FCAT.tv, so you can see our staff. We do kind of a mock call so you can kind of see what a paramedic does. So that's really exciting. They also come and video our monthly Board of Oversight meetings. So those are available so people can go back if they can't make the meeting. Third Thursday of the month at the Public Safety Complex. It is posted in all three towns, so if there's a scheduling conflict, that'll be posted normally. Typically third Thursday, but if you can't make it, FCAT has the recordings available. We also have a pretty robust Facebook social media account where people can message the department. They can also see updates and pictures and things like that. Just because of patient confidentiality and things like that, you won't see all the same kind of nitty-gritty stuff, fun stuff you might see on a police department, just because we want to protect individuals and their health needs. But you can see some shots of people interacting with ambulance and helicopter crews and doing community outreach. So that's a great little place for come to see us. Elementary school visits, we're doing that. Our third truck is free during the day, so we go and we interact with the kids and their parents and kind of give them an opportunity to interact with emergency staff before an actual emergency. So we teach them how to call 911, and if they ever do, it won't be the first time they see us and interact with us. So that's...
Oh, Zach, that's wonderful.
Awesome. Yeah, it's...
I'm so excited about
that. Yeah, and it's nice to have the ability to do that. It's going to sound like I'm selling a third ambulance right now, because I am. That third extra truck in our rotation allows us to do that during the day. So we can still respond to 911s, we can do our intercepts, we can respond to those simultaneous calls, and also do these events. One of the other things that's coming up on June 11th, it's a Saturday, 10:30 to 12:30 at the Sunderland Public Library across the river there, is a Sunderland Touch a Truck event. Put on by the library. So they've asked us, as well as the fire and police departments, to be there. Artie the police dog is going to be there. Artie the police dog. I'm not sure if that's Montague PD or Franklin County Sheriff's actually, but Artie the police dog. That dog has a job.
It might be Montague's, because it's there's only a couple in the whole area.
Yeah. So that's going to be there. And I just heard word that I guess they're going to have some dump trucks there now too. And
nice. What time is that, Zach?
It's 10:30. To 12:30 on June 11th. And, bring the family, kids, bring your parents, and you'll be able to climb around the trucks and interact with the emergency service provider. So just like the same thing we do at the elementary school, come by. Even if you're an adult kid, come on by, poke around,
great.
Play with the flashing lights and stuff like that. And they have a flyer up. It's sunderlandpubliclibrary.org. So you can see the flyer up there. And I mentioned our BOO meetings, Board of Oversight. We call it BOO, typically third Thursday. FCAT's got it. I also do a monthly director's report, which I present at that. Typically comes out mid-month, around the 15th. I talk about the previous month. That gives me a little bit of time to come up with some words. But those are also usually posted on at least the Deerfield website. So that gets forwarded out, and people can read that. Sometimes it's a copy of what's on the Facebook page, sometimes it's some other stuff, but all of our statistics are in there, how many calls we've done, our response times, and what's going on in the department. So that's kind of my department in a nutshell.
Great work, Zach.
Yeah, thank you. It's an honor. Any questions about that before?
No, I'm just very happy that everything is working out.
Yeah. We're very fortunate. We have a lot of fantastic staff that works and kind of makes this all work. And if it were not for them, we wouldn't have the department that we do. So
the question I might have is, have you just recently started this third, if you not third shift, but the day?
That impact shift, yeah, we started it, it was a couple months ago. Okay. And initially when the service was designed, the idea was that we'd have one truck 24/7 and then we'd have people sign up for those additional shifts. Mm-hmm. The reality is we regionalized because we just don't have the local EMTs available. So that same problem has carried through. So instead of trying to pay somebody to be on call during the day when nobody's around, we're actually using that money to pay somebody to physically be in the station and be available. And that has a couple benefits. One is that we have that extra crew available, but also it allows for that engagement. So it brings those people in that now don't get to do as many calls because we have an ambulance. They're actually on the ambulance now at the station, and it frees our full-time staff up to do some other stuff as well.
So in the 3 months that you've had the impact shift, have you seen, do they make enough money to justify it? In other words, are the number of calls that they go on, I mean, you do the budget, I don't.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if the cost to have these people here is $500 a day,
yeah,
do they go on a couple of jobs that generate that kind of money? Or is it a losing proposition?
The short answer is it saves us money to do it ourselves. So if we just get some EMTs, some basic EMTs to respond on an ambulance and do a call, and then we request an intercept, we have an intercept agreement and we pay a certain amount of money automatically to that exceeds the cost of us to staff that truck ourselves. So it's for the same call, if we can do the call by ourselves, it's cheaper than if we have somebody else intercept and give us additional crews to augment.
But you said that we intercept for other communities too.
Yeah.
So we benefit that.
Yes, absolutely. Person. Absolutely. The long answer is it's because we're emergency services department and because we have to be subsidized through tax base and billing, it's kind of a losing battle to start trying to figure out whether something pays for itself or something like that.
The only argument that I would have to that, Zach, is there's a lot of private ambulance companies that make a lot of money.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I mean, how is it? I mean, I don't know anything about it.
Yeah.
But how do they make money?
They do transport.
Like ours,
they do transports.
Do we have to always be subsidized?
So yes, they do transports, and what happens is so everybody who needs a medical transport to or from a nursing home, dialysis, a doctor's appointment, inter hospitals, they call ahead. So that private ambulance company says, okay, that run's going to cost $1,500, and it's going to be at 10 a.m. So I hire my EMT to show up at 9:30, get the ambulance, do the transfer, and then go home when it's done. And so they can maximize their cost and their profit. When you see private ambulance companies that also do 911, They typically do that for a very low fee or almost no money as a way to do just billboards. That they will respond to 911s because they understand it's a losing proposition on the financial, because they'll make up for it when that person needs to call an ambulance and they recognize the truck that brought them to the emergency room or something like that. Emergency services, you know, you're never gonna turn a profit on that type of thing.
But hopefully we're getting closer to break even.
I caution anybody to think that we might ever get there. We're in a really great position just with our demographics and our billing and things like that, where
I know.
We recoup a lot of the expenses and we can offset a lot of our budget with it, that some other communities don't have that luxury. We're doing our best.
I'm really excited. That's really good. Not having to pay the intercept fees is huge.
Yeah.
That was a huge drag on our budget.
Yeah.
You know, that was one of the reasons we weren't making it, is Deerfield EMS, because we were having to pay so many intercepts.
Yeah. I mean, to tens of thousands of dollars.
Tens of thousands of dollars.
Just budgeted to cover those.
I know.
Those expenses, when we're already paying a staff to staff
and our staff has responded.
Right.
Which is, would drive you crazy.
Right.
So
only because I've heard a lot of numbers, you should know. What are the ages of the three ambulances that we currently use?
Oh,
I know Deerfield's is the newest one, but
Deerfield's is the newest one. It's a 2009 or 2010.
Okay.
If you want, I don't want to. The oldest one is a 2001.
That's from Waitley.
That's Waitley.
Yeah, and the Sunderland truck is like a 2004, 2005.
And that's the one that's been budgeted to be replaced.
Well,
you're going to make that the third one.
Yes. So
that will drop to the third
place.
The goal
for us is that our frontline ambulance is a, here, I've got it. Oh. Our frontline ambulance is between 1 and 5 years old, and that does the majority of the calls. Our second line ambulance is between 5 and 10 years old, because they say typically 10 years is the life maximum for an ambulance.
Is there a particular reason for that? I mean, do the vehicles physically get worn out? Is the equipment in that gets outdated?
Yeah, or? So for the same reasons that your average car starts to feel old at 10 years, the bushings and the suspension parts and things stretch and wear out and things like that, motors get tired. There's that. There's also that there's always increasing safety regulations and expectations in ambulances, and the difference between how safe a 10-year-old ambulance is to a 1-year-old ambulance is significant. That you can see very real reductions in staff injuries and fatalities with the newer, updated equipment. So our goal, like I said, just for cost effectiveness, cost of maintenance, and safety, 1 to 5 for the first truck, 5 to 10. Beyond that, that third ambulance is, if that third truck is still healthy enough to do these elementary school things, these touch a truck events, these standbys, to keep it in service. And that comes down to that case-by-case basis, how much is that truck costing us versus how much are we getting back out of it?
Could your service do those transports you were talking about from nursing homes to hospitals?
Yes, it is something that we could do. We're not currently staffed for that.
With that type of service, do you need, I'm just going to use Class A to Class C ambulance. Do you need a Class A ambulance to do those transports versus a Class C ambulance?
No. So any ambulance would work, and they have different types. They have vans, they have boxes, things like that. So you could do it.
So one of our older ambulances could do that if it was a nursing home from, say, Hadley to Northampton.
Right.
And do you foresee that in the future?
It's certainly something that we've got an eye on.
Once you get staffed up.
It's an expanded scope. So, I mean, it's an opportunity for us to see more revenue
we were going towards that.
Yeah. I mean,
Once you're
already paying for all this infrastructure, we're already paying for the staff, we're already paying for everything, and we'd be foolish not to at least
use that ambulance.
Yeah, exactly.
Schedule those.
Right. So there's still costs associated with that,
sure.
The extra ambulance, the extra staffing versus what we're going to get. So that's going to be something that we'd have to look.
Mm-hmm.
2 years in,
right.
You know, we're just trying to find our sea legs right now responding
sure.
to 911 calls, but it's certainly something that, yeah, we have our sights on.
Great.
I know you came here, you wanted us to approve appointments, so.
Well, I'm happy to talk
about
EMS.
But I appreciate you doing this, Zach.
Yeah. Just don't ask me to talk about anything else. I don't know. EMS is great. Highway stuff, not so much. So I've actually got two appointments requested here. I'm actually going to, I want to talk about Mr. James Bardis Sr. first. He's the second on that sheet. Mm-hmm. He's a well-established, highly respected paramedic who's worked all of his career, or at least all of the career I'm aware of, in Franklin County up in Greenfield. And he's a field training officer, and I actually teach at the paramedic program at GCC. He's one of our mentors out in the field that when our paramedic students graduate from the classroom portion and are now riding in the ambulance, he's one of the people that takes on those students, and we're excited every time we can send a student to him. So he's seen what we're doing down here and is actually excited and asked me repeatedly if he could participate, and he's exactly the type of individual that we're looking for around here, especially with this small department. We need everybody to come with experience and things like that. Yeah. So this is just a per diem appointment for Jim Bardis. So he would be filling in those impact shifts or any time that our full-time staff are out or on vacation or things like that. So kind of just
it's wonderful.
Yeah, it's
resource.
Really it's really exciting, and if he's watching, it's going to sound very flattering to him, but having somebody like him on the roster helps us pull other well-established, well-respected medics too. That there's
they want to be around him.
Yeah, EMS is a small community, and word gets around when we have the luxury of filling our ranks with really qualified individuals that everybody else is. That's the type of service I want to be associated with. So,
it's right. Wonderful.
It's great.
Yeah, I'm flattered that he thinks so highly of us. So, and his standard per diem compensation there. All the per diem people make the same compensation. So that's the standard established on that one. And then Alicia Zronig. So one of our full-time staff members, Hannah Eisenstein. She started with us as an EMT basic, has gone through the paramedic program, has continued with us as a paramedic, and has been a wonderful person on our department. Her career aspirations are with a fire-based EMS service. She wants to be a firefighter paramedic. She's also currently a volunteer firefighter in her hometown. So she actually got a job offer from Northampton Fire, and they stole her from us. But I wrote a glowing recommendation because she's great. She's going to be a huge asset to them. And as an EMS agency, I can't offer what she wants in her career. So sad to see her go, but she's stated that she wants to stay on as a per diem member and continue working with us here. So that's something we look forward to in the future. But in anticipation of her moving to Northampton Fire, in our last round of full-time postings, we screened and ranked people understanding that we might have additional openings. And of that, we've already appointed one person for the current open full-time position. Alicia Zronig was our second pick on the list, a very close second. And she said she's still very interested in coming on board full time. Her heart and dream, she's with a private ambulance service now and doesn't get to do the same community outreach that we do here and doesn't have that same community-based fundamental. So she's excited to work for an EMS agency, a standalone EMS agency, and is looking forward to continuing her career with us. She was in the same paramedic class as Hannah Eisenstein at GCC. She was a student of mine, and her graded step would be the paramedic graded step one as a new introductory paramedic. So,
okay,
great.
I make a motion that we appoint Alicia as full time EMS and James as the per diem.
I second.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Have you voted to accept the resignation?
Oh, do we have it? We don't have a
packet.
Oh, is it?
It's a copy of an email, but it's in your packet.
Okay. I make a motion then to accept what's her first name? Alicia?
Hannah Eisenstein.
Oh, Anna. Okay.
Hannah.
Hannah. Oh, I'm sorry. Hannah's resignation. And I'll try to find it.
Oh, I see. Here. It's under administrator's report.
Oh, here it is.
Yep.
Oh, Hannah, I'm sorry. I didn't know. That sounds terrible. I don't think I actually met her. Did I?
We say in EMS, if you don't look familiar,
it's a good thing.
It's probably a good thing. Yeah, when your doctor doesn't goes, "Who are you?" and you say, "I've worked here for a decade," that's usually a good thing.
No, it's terrible. I would try to know everyone that we employ. So you second it?
I make a motion to accept her resignation, Hannah's resignation.
I'll second it.
All right. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you, Zach, for coming in. And thank you for doing an update for us.
Yeah, my pleasure. I hope I didn't monopolize too much of your time there.
Oh, it's great.
No, it's wonderful. We'd really like to, you know, hear from you, you know, every few weeks if you want to come in. It would be really nice. If your report is like in the middle of the month, you know, why don't you come in like the third of the month or something, the third week of the month, whatever lines up, you know, every couple months.
I'd stepped out and I may have missed this. Did you speak to Jim Bartus?
Yes.
That was an appointment that was made?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep.
Both Jim and
Alicia.
And Alicia. Oh, okay.
And I think that's wonderful that Jim is willing to work with us.
Yeah. We got a great staff. I hope you never have to call us, but if you do, rest assured.
Like to just come and visit.
Yeah. That's right. Touch a truck. Come see us.
Right. Yeah. We'll do that.
Zach, will you be able to be here 2 o'clock on Friday?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm on the ambulance that day, so barring an emergency,
okay,
I will be here.
I'll try to remind you. Thank you. It'll take all of 5 minutes.
Yeah. So I know what that's about. Yep.
Alan, was there ever any discussion about having the EMTs paramedics do that health screening?
Oh, yeah. We're as soon as they get full staff and settle down. Yeah. I mean, there was, you know, some of them were training and stuff. We were going to do some outreach and they were going to start doing some
going on seniors, that kind
of yes. blood pressure clinics. And great. I mean, I'm glad to see that they were
doing
to
talk about changing the operational duties of the EMS, you have to do it through the Board of Oversight.
Yes, we will.
Okay.
But that was part of the original discussion that some of this we would end up having the staff in one place. The whole idea was that then they would be able to be assigned to do
different items,
different things in the communities that we're not really doing now or that you know is only spottily done. That was what was exciting about, you know, eventually moving on.
Yeah.
Were you here for any reason? Oh.
Yep.
Doug, where's... Oh.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
I did have a couple of different back and forth emails with David Gilbert Keith, who's the chair of the Energy Conservation Committee.
Is he feeling better?
He's the chair of that committee, yep. And I wish I could have, but I was not able to attend their meeting and presentation last week, but I plan to attend the next meeting. There were some concerns that were raised at that gathering about... honestly, about relations between the administrator's office and the Energy Resources Committee and how that relationship has been managed or maybe not so well managed over the past X years, what have you. And the concerns were expressed very eloquently, very clearly, and very professionally through David to me. About halfway through a draft email, I realized I was doing the wrong thing. So I picked up the phone and I called him. And David and I had a very good, very positive, productive conversation for about 10 minutes, which cleared up a great deal of maybe, I would say, misconceptions or misunderstandings. And in a nutshell, what he and I talked about was that the Energy Conservation Committee has and continues to be a source of information, for lack of a better term, a tool that this board can use to research options for energy conservation, options for energy generation, and to be an advisory board on any project that happens to go out there in the town related to solar. On its docket, on the committee's docket, is the transfer station on Lee Road and the possibility of placing solar there. I did have a conversation with David, but I wanted to confirm or consult with you folks as well. When last we left our heroes at the transfer station, we were talking about leasing the land for a third party to come along, build a solar plant on that land. In exchange, the town would get a lease payment for the land, personal property tax on the solar equipment itself, and potentially be able to enjoy a net metering credit deal. In other words, be able to reduce our electricity costs. But I made it very clear that at this point, I do not foresee the fiscal capability of Deerfield to take on a $5 million solar generation construction project, that it's just outside of the scope of ability for the town. There's no appetite for it. And I said to David, I said, we've got a consultant, Beth Greenblatt. I'm trying to remember the name of her company.
I don't think we've used up even a portion of that.
No, we've used up a very small amount, a few hundred dollars. Yep. And it's a $12,000 contract with Beth.
When's the money have to be given back if we don't use it? Don't we have another year?
It just has to be used. I think it's 2 or 3 years.
Yeah, but we've used up a year. So maybe it's at least another year.
Yeah. I mean, we do need to get moving on that, but she's available to provide consulting.
Okay.
And so the recommendation I made to David is that that the Energy Resources Committee work with Beth to draw up a request for proposals and then have Beth manage that procurement to be able to, or at least to do the issuance of the proposals, get them out there, market the possibility, receive the proposals back, and then provide an evaluation with the committee to present a recommendation to this board for award.
Does that sound like what you all talked about?
I think one step further on recommending that Beth become the clerk of the works for the project. Maybe not herself personally, but such that when we have a project like this going on, we get a weekly report, a monthly report, quarterly report, right to the select board. Everybody knows, because this last episode has been kind of continuous communications. And everyone I ask about, well, I don't know. I think it's this or something.
Right.
We would have to that wouldn't be under the scope of the grant that we have now, but it would be, we could fund it through the project.
Yep.
Beth could make sure that that is funded through the project.
Just a very minor.
I would feel comfortable with Beth, but I think that's a good idea. I think that's a wonderful idea to have a clerk of the works, because it isn't fair to ask our highway superintendent to do it.
Just last night, I was at the Franklin Regional Council of Governments, FERC, energy. So I'm on both of these. And there was a feeling there, too, that smaller towns just can't cope with larger projects, just are the same. And we may have people who have the academic or even some professional experience, but not in the technical field, which has surprises. And so that's why Beth would probably be the first candidate to seriously consider. And because she would be working with us, it's not a lot of money. We're not bringing someone from Colorado or Maine to do that. She's local.
I agree with you 100%. And I also feel that we might get more service from the electric company. I mean, the electric company just is very slow at responding.
One last thing for the two new gentlemen. Please consider the Energy Committee to be an income generator. Now, Ben Franklin said a penny saved is a penny earned. So whether we're doing energy conservation and saving the purchase of energy, or we're generating energy, that comes to the town.
It does.
Right.
So we as a committee are essentially beating the bushes for bucks. But we need your support and acknowledgement and understanding what the process is. So if we say, help me, help me this, we don't have to have 3 months of rumination at the select board. Somebody can just say, oh, let's do this.
I would be very excited if we can move forward on the transfer station. We've been trying to do that for at least 5 years or 6 years. 6 years, whatever.
So
it's
would
been
you
quite
like
a long
the Energy
time.
Resources Committee to work with Beth to draw up an
so.
RFP?
Do you feel yeah. like
sure.
that?
Excuse me, sir. What's your first name?
J-A-Y.
J-A-Y.
S-T-R-Y.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay.
I should add.
The Energy Resource Committee, is it also an energy conservation?
The actual name of the committee is the Energy Conservation Committee.
What I would like to see is to invite that board to one of our meetings to talk about, I'm all pro-solar, and I think it's a great idea, but our town has taken on a lot of projects where the energy that we consume far outweighs the benefit of all the solar that's going on now. And I just happened to see plans for a new library that, you know, contains a boatload of glass, and I would like the Energy Conservation Committee to get involved and take a look at some of these things and maybe, you know, make a recommendation on their own that, hey, you know, look at this is not a wise design. The amount of fossil fuels that we're going to burn to keep this facility warm and the cost for decades to come is something we really need to consider, you know.
I just over at the meeting. Their presentation, and that came up, one of the questions came up, well, actually two things, about the glass, mm-hmm. and the other thing was about the possibility of introducing solar on the roof system. And so I agree as far as, it just seems that there needs to be more communication in town, and maybe we could work through some of these things, be a little smarter and wiser on how we approach things.
Sure.
Good point.
Well, the roof lines there don't quite match up with
with
using solar.
You're not going to be able to.
That's to be discussed. Right.
Yeah.
But
okay.
I just thought I'd mention that. At least it came up.
Thank you, Jeff.
I mean, the benefit that the town might have if a solar project went on the landfill, you know, we get certain credits. You know, I think that would be the way to go to try and fit a limited amount of solar panels on that library building, which is really only about 4,500 square feet.
Right.
You know, I don't know the benefit of that. In today's, a lot of the LED lights and smarter electric motors really consume a very little electricity compared to even, you know, 10 years ago. But heating systems and air conditioning still gobble up electricity and gas and or oil. And that's where, you know, we need to be smarter making these buildings energy efficient, you know, and not just from an engineer's point of view. Well, it meets the code just barely. And the energy code has a lot of loopholes, so they can, you know, put in products that actually consume more energy. But because they're the so-called green product, you get a credit for it. In reality, they burn more fuel, so, you know, It's something that, you know, I would sure love to have somebody else looking at this and saying that, you know, we need to be a little smarter on these choices.
Absolutely.
Supposedly the grant that they're pursuing requires the building to be energy efficient. Mm-hmm. Well, what does that mean?
Right.
Well, my point is to that exactly, you know, Deerfield is one of the green communities in the Stretch Energy Code, and this is a prime example that there's a new line of electric water heaters out there, hybrids, and they're kind of like a heat pump where they take the ambient air temperature in the basement and it actually raise the temperature of the water. It uses more energy than its equal gas, natural gas, or propane gas water heater. But because it runs by electricity, and the Commonwealth and our federal government now say electricity is the green energy, they're saying it's better to use this, even though you're burning more. But, you know, to make the electricity, you're burning coal, oil, or natural gas.
Right.
You know, so if you look at the big picture, it's not better. But because of the way the rules are set up, they seem that way. So, you know, we have to, or at least from my point of view, I want to look beyond what the rules say and make the building energy efficient, not just what the paperwork says. You know?
Right.
I think everybody's goal is the same, that operationally wise, we want to keep our expenses as the absolute minimum because we can't afford to take on more expense. So right. I just from that point of view, we need to look at the amount of glass and what we're doing in that building once we get in line and get you know, the footprint approved. I think there could be a lot of discussion operationally what would be the best first sustainability. I mean, we just have to think that way, and it's not anything. I think there's huge consensus on that, and obviously we want it to be attractive, but we do have to have the sustainability has got to be a major factor. We just can't take on open-ended operational costs.
And, you know, the highway garage was a prime example. I mean, you know, the old garage, it was a barn. But when people look at the cost of the highway garage, that's just one thing. Look at the cost of operation to that building now. And I mean, the old, I don't believe we even had insurance on the old barn. Now we're paying a hefty insurance premium. So there's a lot that goes on with carrying costs, you know, and the year-to-year operation that, you know, we really have to take into consideration. Well, but the energy is an important thing.
I don't think anyone really cared whether we insured the old one or not, but we certainly care that we insure the new one.
Right.
So, yes, there are some costs that you can't avoid. Okay. So, Doug, do you feel that that's okay? You know, a discussion, because I didn't really see you here on the agenda, and I didn't want to cut you off.
It was going to be part of my report, just to mention the project and to mention the fact that we had had the conversation.
Okay.
If you are willing to charge the Energy Conservation Committee to work with Beth Greenblatt to develop an RFP for the solar on the landfill, then we'll make that happen. If you would like to charge the Energy Conservation Committee to come back to you with a report on other potential energy savings projects that could be done at other town buildings, you can charge them to do that. If you would like to charge them to become active and to advise on the proposed design for the library, you can ask them to do that.
Absolutely.
Then what I can do is put a letter together and to that effect.
Yep.
Carolyn, if you would like to review it before signing it, and we'll get it to David and the committee.
Okay.
And in my opinion, that's definitely the right way to do it, because that identifies clear desire on the part of the board to get information on the part of this committee, and presents a clear charge to the committee saying, we're asking for this information, please provide it.
And Jay, you feel comfortable that that is what you're looking for, right? Okay.
Wonderful.
That would be wonderful.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, no, that would be fantastic, because I feel like we really would love the input for the library. And I know personally I would really like to move ahead on the landfill. I mean, it's crazy not to have be utilizing that right away.
She's emeritus, I think, or something like that, with many, many, many good observations and suggestions, and some of her suggestions.
That's good.
That's in the past.
Well, I think it's very important that we move ahead, and energy is only going to get more expensive in the long run. I mean, right now we have a little bit, we're enjoying a little bit of a break, but it's going to be long term. It's going to keep going up, and if we can minimize the expense, it would be huge for our budgets. One of the things, just when we do work out a deal, I would just want to make sure that we try to include Frontier. You know, in the, you know, if we get a discount on our energy somehow, and we do is some kind of net metering, that we, even though the school district Frontier is separate, it would be nice. It's right here in town, and it would be nice to have the net metering agreement. I have the opportunity to include Frontier. Obviously, they have to vote to be included, but if we get to that point, I just don't want Frontier to be left out.
Sure. There are a number of models that are going to be considered when it comes to solar on the landfill. And actually, I learned quite a bit from some information that David sent to me, whether the town considers going for a commercial vendor to build the solar, or if they're going for looking to a co-op to actually put something together. There are different benefits to each. There are different limitations to each. In terms of developing solar, there's a whole lot of parking lot over at Frontier Regional, and there's no reason why that parking lot could not also be leased to a company to build a carport / solar, big wide open space, where then the school could benefit from net metering credit. And again, a developer provides a lease to the landowner to build the thing at the developer's cost. The school would then get a lease payment. The town would get personal property payments, and the developer would be able to sell the energy and make money. So all of these are possible.
Oh, no, it's fine. I just didn't want some, you know, it's a separate entity from the town, and I just didn't want them to miss the opportunity. So, I mean, they obviously the school committee has to vote and all that kind of stuff, but I just wanted to make sure
they're
included.
To follow up on his thoughts, so you know, and Trevor, the folks from Lake Street Development expressed interest in
landfill. They want to be notified if an RFP is going to be issued.
And that's why we'd kind of like to get going, because if they, I mean, from what I understand, they seem to be very reasonable to work with. And
they are. And the other
they
thing
seem
is,
very nice, and I would like to continue the relationship with them.
Since they first brought that project forward about a year ago, the technology has changed where they could have made it even more powerful, you know, for the size that would benefit us.
Mm-hmm. But that's where Beth can come in, because one of the hang-ups with them was the connection with the electric company, and having Beth on board to help navigate that whole thing would be huge, because that was a huge stumbling block. It was Eversource was not being very cooperative. So it would be nice to sort that out. Yes, Jay.
On a little tidbit I also learned last night, I hope you put a smile on your face. The Massachusetts Supreme Court has ruled that Massachusetts shall do all of this stuff, has issued a 2-week limit for each department to prepare and send a schedule. Project management of this. Now, they've got plenty of projects because they've been doing this for 5 years without ever coming to fruition. The Supreme Court said, time to do it.
So does this mean that DPU has to list? So Eversource will cooperate then?
Sounds like they will.
That is very good news, and that does put a smile on my face. Thank you very much.
My source is Bob Dean.
Oh, great.
I did hear that as well.
So forth. I may not have the story completely straight, but the humorous part is that several of the Massachusetts departments have said, well, we really can't study it more. We have to hire consultants. The humor comes in when everything that we're talking about has already been done in Denmark. All you guys have to do is ask for a photocopy of their projects, put Massachusetts stamp on it, so no more dilly-dallying around with, well, we've got to study this and that.
Spend more money on
Supreme
studies.
Court says, do it.
Great.
I think that's wonderful.
Well, it would be nice to make DPU jump through some hoops. Thank you, Jay. If that's sort of, you feel like that's finalized then, Doug? That's okay. Thank you, Jay, for coming in. I really appreciate it.
Thank you guys for here again. Welcome to.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much. So we'll be working together.
Yes.
Bye bye. We'll go back to approval of the minutes from May 4th, May 9th, May 18th, and May 25th. Did you guys have a chance to?
Had a chance to review them and make a motion to accept the minutes.
I'll second it.
Okay. All those. Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Please make that unanimous for all sets of minutes. Um, Was there any select board updates? Kip, did you go to the Tilton Library one?
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Yes.
So did you want to just talk a minute about that?
Well, I take that back. You know, no, I didn't. The only thing I was at our last selectmen's meeting over there.
Oh, okay. Because, yes. You know, what we do is we sort of do any updates if we have anything. But you had said that you were interested in just because of the glass issues.
Right. I think they're meeting tonight.
Their meeting was tonight.
Same time
as our meeting. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
I did speak with Nancy, the chair of the Tilton Library.
Nancy Maynard.
Mentioned the fact that the select board would not be able to attend the public information session tonight due to the meeting conflict. I asked if there would be future opportunities for the board to learn more. She said likely that there would be, and she would keep us advised. She is going to be, of course, making the motions at town meeting next Monday in regard to the two items on the warrant for the library. Mm-hmm. She's prepared to do that and to speak to it.
How do you deal with a situation like this where their project manager or designer said that you can change the interior of the building, but the footprint you can't? So
5% or something like that.
Yeah, we don't really know what the cost is, and there's a lot. And it kind of seems to me we're going down that same road like with the school roof. So we're going to have a building in front of us with not even an accurate cost, and I know that it's just going, they're looking for grant money and stuff like that, but as it goes through this thing, I can see in a year from now saying, well, you know, this is what was approved, this is what at special town meeting you guys accepted, and, you know, I just see a whole bad scenario coming down. And then, I mean, I didn't sit here, but you did, when the folks from the roof committee, they spent 3 hours, and all they wanted to know is where are they gonna, how are they going to get their money, you know, that to heck with the roof, how are they going to get their money? And I'm afraid
we
that...
We had design issues.
Right. But it's going to... I'm afraid that this is going to happen again. So how do you go about saying yes to going ahead with, you know, looking for grants, but not really saying, okay, we all are on board with this exact same design?
Well, the footprint can be adjusted, and also the use of the footprint.
Can it be shrunk more than 5? I know they said you can only adjust it
by 5.
Right. I didn't know if you could shrink it more than 5%. Or.
If I may, one thing that we heard today at the finance forum in Worcester is that, and they were talking about annual budget development, and that the first step in annual budget development was developing a broad estimate for revenues, and then using that to drive the development of departmental budgets. I think that now is a very, very good time for the select board to make a decision, possibly in concert with the finance committee or the assessors, as to how much you want to pay. Or at least you could consider doing that. We're willing to consider a library addition that doesn't exceed $2 million cost to the town of Deerfield. I'm making that number up, you know,
right, but
whatever.
And I like that. I like that train of thought. But the way we're going, that's not going to come into play at all because,
correct.
You know,
yeah.
I can foresee this getting to a spot where, you know, a typical library, not these are not my words, I'm fantasizing it. The typical library is $300 a square foot. So that's going to put your, you know, 9,000 square foot thing at, you know, $6 million. Or it's typically, you know, $800 a foot. Now it's going to be $10 million, you know, and then that doesn't include the renovation costs. And that's why... I'm very leery about stuff like that. I'd like to take that type of a suggestion. Just look at we're willing to spend up to a certain dollar amount and, you know, work within that parameters. These people who put together this library plan, I'm sure they spent time speaking with our trustees to find out what their needs were and stuff like that. But pretty much what I saw over there was computer generated, that somebody who's pretty savvy with those programs probably could have developed in a couple of days. So, I don't know.
Well, it's a good discussion for town meeting. Yes, Jeff.
I was over there. I asked those same questions. Kept the assurance, and they weren't able to provide me any numbers at the moment because they have to scrub them, and they don't want to throw numbers out to the town at the moment. This is just supposedly what they described to me was. Monday night was going to be two votes, basically just giving them authority to pursue the grant, and there would be a third vote down the road.
So the third vote is the actual
cost. But I did kind of throw out, we talked a little bit about a square foot, and there is another person there. I don't know if he wants me to mention his name or not, so I won't. But the question came up, and what are we looking at for current libraries that this company has been doing? And, you know, there is some discussion of if they had to do a rough ballpark, it'd be $350 to $400 per square foot. And but they couldn't, you know, they wouldn't commit to that either. So that does, I think, leave the town. You know, as I said to them, you may have some people coming Monday night that want to hear numbers, you know. So they don't know when they're going to be able to produce those numbers. They feel they have to scrub them. And I share your concerns, Kip. A lot of people did put, you know, I do want to say this publicly, there's a lot of people on that committee that put a lot of time and energy into this.
Oh, yes.
So I don't want to just blow that off.
Oh, no.
It's, you know, it's an important project.
It is. But there's a part of that that, to me, and maybe it's my business background, it's a marketing thing, because the committee or the town expressed the desire or wishes to build an addition onto the library. And so now the designer comes and shows them a beautiful picture of all the stuff in there, and it's the marketing. It's selling, this is what you want, this is what you ask for, this is what you can get, you know, and there's no numbers, and then, you know, the people keep believing that this is it, this is it, this is the golden egg, and then all of a sudden when you get the numbers, maybe even the committee themselves is kind of like, wow, I didn't think this would be that much, but now the marketing aspect is, all right, this is what we wanted, and I gave you what you asked for, and this is what they go for.
Actually, you know? It was Mark that was on the committee, but they did go through a needs assessment, and Jeff, you were there for a couple of the presentations over the winter.
They did.
It was a needs assessment, so I think the footprint. Well, the footprint does reflect some of the needs, and what they identified as needs.
Right.
And so I'm leery of the footprint not being able to adjust the footprint more than 5%, but what was presented, you know, like the glass walls and all that kind of stuff, that all can be changed, and what you end up with can be dramatically different,
right,
cost-wise. So
I'm not, and I hope I expressed my thoughts clearly enough, is that's part of the presentation, is saying to the committee, these are the things that you asked for, and, you know, this is what we came up with, but without knowing that number, and, you know, it can be, how can I say, it's,
well, I think
it's like
everybody's
having
had sticker shock, though.
Instead of having a $200 lock set, you have a $5,000 lock set. And I'm not saying that's going to happen, but it's that kind of thing. When you don't know the numbers, you don't know what's there. You know, what it is you're being sold something, and you're being sold exactly what you asked for. So it's hard to resist afterwards, you know. And then what happens is you get the people who want it, you know, they were sold this, and the people who just look at the dollar sign and say, oh, my God, you know, yeah, we need it, but... You know, and that's why I don't like, and I'm not against this project at all, trust me. It's just I don't like, you know, approving something without having a dollar amount attached to it.
I think, like I said, I think we're all pretty leery because we've had such sticker shock with between
sure.
the highway garage and the
yeah.
roof.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah.
nobody thought it was a $3 million roof, I can tell you that.
Mm-hmm. One thing I also learned with the grant, as they explained it, that this particular grant that they're pursuing, and it's a time factor now, will not allow that to be used as a multi-purpose building, such as incorporating the senior center.
Oh, it won't. I thought they could have a community center.
Completely contrary to common sense. I'm sorry.
Back when this first started, when this initially started, the senior center would have had to have their board together and running a similar process as far as what their needs were, so on and so forth, to be able to try to work
So it's not a community center? So, I mean, it's not a community center room?
They're going to create an 80-person community room. That's at least is what's being proposed, but it cannot be used as a senior center. They can have meetings. Seniors can, you know, attend the room.
You can run programs.
But as far as having it as a multi-purpose, that the grant, as they're pursuing this, will not allow that.
Well, I don't think there's enough room for a senior center and a library in that thing anyway, so.
Yeah, right? No, I didn't mean a full.
They can still do functions there.
I do know that prior to Marlene being here, that Diana Damon did actually do the starting steps of considering what was necessary for a senior center. She actually did some investment and did a lot of the same space analysis and needs analysis. And her information, her document, took the same form as the needs analysis I saw from the library. Mm-hmm. It listed the amount of space, square footage, its purpose, and a broader definition as to why it was an important or necessary part of the senior center. And had an invitation been extended, that could have been provided, and it could have been included in the preliminary drafts. And I also do know that at least 2 years ago, I think both the senior center and also a nonprofit in town actually spoke with folks at the library and said, is there interest in creating a broader community center? Can we pool our resources and pool our needs together to save the town money and to create a better space than any one organization could on its own? And the response was that there's no interest in working to develop a broader community space, that they were looking at only an extension to the library.
So that comment was from the Tilton?
It was from someone associated with the Tilton Building Committee, yes. Yeah.
So they're just focusing on that anyways.
Yeah.
But it's extremely frustrating
that the conversation can't be expanded.
Jeff, are you saying that they can't have programs there? You can't run programs in that
community? No, they can run programs on occasion, but they can't use it as a legitimate senior center.
Okay. But that's different.
Right.
Yeah, I understand that.
They can use, if they want to hold a weekly meeting or something, they can.
That was the attractiveness, is because we really, truly didn't have a good community.
The way it's designed right now, they can isolate the library and leave that community room open for groups to use.
But it can't be
The only sad part I see as a taxpayer is that, once again, here we are, we're going to have one building over here, and we're going to have another building over here at double the cost.
Yeah.
And one in the middle that we don't know what's going to happen.
Right, exactly. One in the middle that we don't know what's going to happen to. So it's just sad that we could not coordinate that and save taxpayers money. That's all.
Can it still be done?
But you're saying that the program, it limits it. The program is not eligible. The grant program is not.
I don't know if that's true or not, because question has to be asked if there's... from what I could see, from what they're presenting, these grants, this grant comes up around maybe every five or six years.
Eight to ten.
Yeah.
So you would have to put that off for another whatever and try to coordinate the two right from the get-go to make that happen. And I think they're so far along in their process that I don't think there's a lot of interest there.
To start
if that's even doable, that's something that we would
if correct me if I'm wrong, Kip. If you put a shovel into the ground on a large commercial project, you've spent dollars.
Right.
If you add another floor, you spent dollars more. And those are predictable numbers. And you can either break it out by square foot, break it out by facility, what's in the building, what have you. But as soon as you put a shovel into the ground, you've spent money, because you've already had an architect, you've had design, you've had engineering, you've had plans drawn up, you've done permitting, and so on and so forth. Boom, you spent money to do a thing. At a floor, you've spent more money to do a thing at a third floor. Regardless of how you dress the inside, there's fixed costs that you need to build four walls with some windows and a roof. If the question for the town, I think, might be, how much can the town get from this grant from the state versus how much will the town spend on creating a space for a separate physical building as a senior center? And does it make sense to push the grant to the wayside, go at our own, even though the bottom line is going to be higher for taxpayers, but knowing that you're getting the benefit of multi-organizational collaboration?
I think that's what will be answered in the process. I mean, we, you know, they'll get accepted. The footprint will be discussed. I mean, that's part of the whole town meeting process.
Doug, I thought the same thing. I thought about that too, exactly what you're just saying.
You know, it's the thing that keeps coming up with the elementary school roof.
Yeah.
If the town had not gone with the MSBA grant, but instead just hired, you know, issued a request for proposals, invitation for bid, hired local roofers, we may actually have spent less money in the long run. Who knows? That's speculation. I'm not saying that would have happened.
But not only we would have saved money, we could have had a roof that would not leak because it wouldn't have been shingled. You know, you only have basically a 5-inch break point because on a 5-pitch roof, you know, for every foot it goes this way, it goes up 5 inches.
Yeah, but we asked about metal because one of the things I wanted to do was why not put a metal roof on there and not have, thank you so much, not have the potential for a leak. And the metal roof they quoted was more expensive.
Oh, I read that, Carolyn, and it was such hogwash. It was same thing. It was marketed to what you want. It was tailored to it. When I saw those prices of that metal roof, I talked with the people who did, I talked with the Prudential Committee, found out who the contract was, found out their price on that roof was about not even a third of what was in that proposal. You know, and I was like, what the, you know, and that was why I was so upset, you know, but it's nothing that you can get up at town meeting, and even if you kind of go on for 10 minutes, you know, it's a bigger picture. You know, so I tried to be brief. Look, you can do this kind of a roof, and the fire department just did it for this kind of money, and then you get other parts of the committee and say, no, you can't. And I go, why? I mean, you know, I talked with, not only I've been doing this for 40 years, I mean, I talked with people who currently just did a job for the town of Deerfield, you know, the fire department, maybe not the town, but, and could they do the same thing? Yes. But by that point, that's what I'm saying.
Too late.
By that point, it was too late. The wheels were, in gear. We already made a commitment to the Mass School Building Authority. They picked people. Money was expended. You know, the wheels were turning. You know, and that's what I'm just, it's not difficult to do it right. It just don't, you can't get wrapped up in this rush to judgment because those are the consequences, you know.
Mm-hmm. Let's keep ahead of the library.
Yep. Means we need to do that. Okay.
Moving on.
Yes. Let's get down to the road reclassification request. Doug?
Sure. You have in your packet some information related to, and I'm skipping forward. Actually, do you want to do the Board of Health report?
You want to do the Board of Health?
You have something in your packet? It's an email from Lisa White. It's basically a report. Maybe this is just a report. It's in relation, some information in relation to the CPHS flu vaccination program. And Lisa just submitted an update on how the program went this past year. There's a very long PowerPoint that relates a great deal of information. Feel free to look at it at your leisure. But if you skip down past the PowerPoint, there's a couple of charts after that, I believe. And there's one kind of looks like this right here. It's a chart labeled CPHS 2015-2016 flu vaccine tally by town. It's extremely telling. Conway, 127 vaccinations, doses were issued. Shelburne, 23. Shelburne Falls, 90. Gill, 27. Deerfield, 289.
That's great.
More than twice the number of vaccinations were dosed out in Deerfield than in any other town, which is tremendous.
It's part of our EDS.
Exactly. And that, I think, is directly attributable to the EDS, the emergency dispensing site. program that Carolyn has spearheaded over the past several years. Lisa, in her email, I believe she states that it definitely goes to the credit of Deerfield for the success of the program in our town. She says, we've not received all reimbursements at this time. However, she believes the estimate provided in the second to last slide is solid, that the reimbursements are on their way. And she expects that we will get enough to continue the program in the coming fiscal year. So,
where does the money actually go to?
That I may not have the answer to.
Because we do have to pre-purchase the vaccine. They're no longer giving us free vaccine. But I was wondering what we are not doing because we don't have the free vaccine is we're not exercising our emergency dispensing site. So what I would like to do is use some money towards at least one evening of doing a call down drill. And we probably would not need more than $300 or $400 to do the put together the evening. But
okay, is that, you know, money we had already our, in the health Board of Health
well,
budget?
I didn't know where the money for the insurance, because what happens is when you go and get a shot from Lisa now, you bring your insurance card, mm-hmm. and you're given get $25 towards the shot over and above the, you get reimbursed the vaccine, which we pre-bought.
Sure.
Out of our money, and then we get $25. So we're making $25 per shot. And what we do is use the majority of it to buy vaccine again. But there should be a little bit of money left over because the vaccine is about $20 or $22 a dose. So, because you're buying it from the state.
Okay.
Or you're doing it through the state. So the little extra money, I'd like to see if we could use it towards organizing some kind of drill in September, October, when we normally would have our EDS, and what it would be a single evening. You know how we did it?
Elementary school.
Yeah. Right?
A couple years back?
Yes. And it's just to keep our volunteer list active in case we have another H1N1 incident or something like that. Because when we ran those multiple clinics for that H1N1, we were really successful, and we were able to, you know, pretty much blanket the community and all the at-risk people, especially, you know, families with babies under 6 months, because that was the most vulnerable. So I hate to lose our, it's been a year. Our volunteer lists are, you know, getting out of, you know,
Carol,
out of date.
Just so I understand, I mean, I see the numbers, but you take towns like Northampton and Amherst where they had no people. I mean,
they must do it different through a different program.
Did they do it differently? I mean, why? What is it? What is the benefit to the residents of Deerfield? I mean, is this flu shot for them for free? Where if they went somewhere else, they would pay money?
When we were doing the emergency dispensing drill, we got about $20,000 to $25,000 worth of vaccine mm-hmm. from the state for free. I mean, there was no charge.
Sure.
We ran our EDS and we serviced whoever showed up. You know, it was like on the average, we did between 800 and 900 people.
Okay, all of these people, they all got a shot here, but this town is just representative of where they lived.
Right.
Okay.
And so now because we get no free vaccine, we were able to pre-buy the vaccine. And what happens is when you come in with your insurance card, you still don't pay. You don't pay like a copay.
Sure.
If at a doctor's office or anything, it's like going to CVS. You could just show your insurance card and you get your shot. Mm-hmm. So what Lisa's providing is, you know, to our seniors or to students, and she goes over to the elementary school. She does it in multiple places. Mm-hmm. Does the senior center? You show your insurance card, so the insurance is charged the cost of the vaccine plus an administrative fee, but we pay Lisa as our public health nurse, so that fee is money towards next year's vaccine, but also there's a little bit left over. And what I want to do is make sure that we have, you know, money to buy some pizza and, you know, evening.
I'm still missing it. So people here, 127 people came from Conway to Deerfield.
No, she went up to Conway.
Oh, she went up to Conway.
Yeah. This is part of our public health district.
The FERCOG.
Yeah, at the FERCOG. She's a nurse to all these towns.
Okay.
But we took most advantage of it, from what I understand, right?
Okay.
Well, we have the most participants, I think, from it's a hangover from our emergency dispensing group. People are used to coming in and doing it through our EDS, so they just come in and see Lisa during, because she's here every Wednesday. But I was just hoping, that we, sometime in the fall, no big deal, but one evening, come in, have our just-in-time training, because we have a module all set up. Liz Kugler is like our chief operator, and she set up a really good video that's just, and then we could have, pizza and go through the whole thing, so we could do some more training, update training with people, recruiting the kids. We had the kids that were in the GCC nursing program come and help, and then once they got their license, they were able to, we've had quite a few good volunteers. Mm-hmm. So I hate to give up that connection with GCC, so maybe we can have GCC students come down and work with us, and that way, when they are working in the area, that's good volunteers for us, and they're young. I mean, a lot of our volunteers are getting older. I mean, we did this for 9 years, so a lot of us, we're not that old when we started. So we want to have some youth out there so that, if we had a real emergency, it's an all day. Yeah, and we have to do shifts. So, we have a core group of 90 volunteers, and if we can keep that active, that's really huge, 90 to 100. You have the ability to run shifts, and you have the ability to do your whole community, and that's really what's necessary if we
have a problem.
And interact, if we activate any of our plans, because we have four plans that we do: home delivery, we do Frontier, we did elementary school and the town hall, and we did our drive-through. And so we have four plans that we practice over the years, and just keep people familiar with it, so and they understand the terminology and the ICS, the incident command structure. And like I said, we had 9 years of really good working together, and we handled. You could go through our drive-through in 5 minutes, and we had the potential of doing all four towns, all residents, all 12,000 residents in a day.
And what has changed in the last year? Meaning, we're not getting the money from the state.
The state used to give us free vaccine.
Yep.
And it's, $20,000 to $25,000 donation. And
they're no longer.
When Charlie Baker got elected, that was one of the things that was cut, was
vaccination.
Vaccine to communities, yeah. It was one of the DPH cuts. So, I understand it wasn't a priority, so. But it has impact on readiness for us, and that really is, Bob Morrison, who is in charge of the vaccine program, we need to figure out how we can do this, because there is always leftover vaccine at the end of the year. The problem is the majority of people have already gotten their flu shots, which they should have, because you don't get a shot and have immediate immunity. It's, 10 to 14 days. And a really good flu match, when the flu's circulating, there's all kinds of strains,
right.
And a match on the flu shot could be like 80%. That's like
last
really
good. Last year was
good.
The year before was not good.
It was terrible. And so you need to be able to get different kinds of, options for people that have that are immune suppressed and all that kind of stuff. So there's usually vaccine that's left over, but by then, January, number one, the weather's terrible, and no one wants to do any kind of drive-through. But the possibility of getting some free vaccine, it might be worth, maybe there'd be some people that haven't gotten already their shots, so it would be worth doing something. There's a possibility of doing that, too.
Okay. So we keep that open?
Yeah.
All right.
What's next?
As long as we're on the Board of Health thing, instead of going to the road classification request, why don't we just do the mosquito control? contract. I did have a MAPCO meeting earlier today, this afternoon, and I talked to Nicole Zapko from Greenfield. The mayor signed off on the contract in Greenfield, but he signed off on the original contract, not our amended contract. So she was going to ask him, did he have any problem with our amendments, which was pretty much boilerplate.
Right. Yeah,
so
she received that contract last
week. I did not call VCDI because VDCI because I didn't know if they were going to sign, if the mayor had a problem with our amended contract. So,
do you wait?
We need to sign this because then we'll sign our version.
And then have him sign our version,
and then I'll go to the company and see, because all it is boilerplate.
This is for that mosquito trapping?
Mm-hmm. Yes. I know you don't agree.
I'm not.
That's okay, but can I make a bet with you? A beer at the Polish Club?
All right,
breakfast at Jerry's. Breakfast at Jerry's. How about that? In December, I will either agree with you or you'll agree with me. Let's do just a bet.
I think we should do it for a year.
Hell no, and
I'll get a full accounting of what we have. And by December, we have to.
Well, right, but by December we have to be making decisions for the next budget year.
Right.
So we're either going to continue,
or we're not. Correct.
So since
the town had voted for it and wanted to go forward with this program, let's move ahead for 1 year and revisit it in December.
Yeah. No, I know. I'm just giving Kip a hard time, and I'm hoping that he would make a bet with me for Jerry's breakfast.
Well, if you want to go to Jerry's, I'll take you to Jerry's.
No. I just don't agree with it, Carolyn.
I can't, you know. But
Kippy, if you're looking at money, let me just tell you, adult deciding, waiting until they're adults, it's called adult deciding, getting rid of them as adults. That spraying, number one, is hugely expensive. Lava siding is so much cheaper.
Mosquitoes only live like 14 days.
Yeah, but if what we're trying to do is get information and data if there's anything that we have to mitigate, and you mitigate on a lava siding basis versus adulticiding, and we don't want to get to the adulticiding because, you know, what about the bluebirds? What about all that?
You can't kill them all.
You can't. And some mosquitoes are harmless. I mean,
they all hurt.
I know, but some of them don't. It doesn't matter. I mean, they're part of the food.
You'd be like Mao and kill every insect because then we'll have birds.
You know, some of them are part of the food chain and they're harmless.
Yeah.
But there are three or four varieties that are terrible.
Well,
we need to identify where they're breeding.
How can you get rid of that?
But that's why they trap them. They have different kinds of traps to trap different kinds of mosquitoes.
Are they going to get permission from the landowner to go on?
Well, they're going to assess the town, and based on the number of complaints I get that we're not doing anything, even though we're throwing out discs, I'm sure there's not going to be any issues, Kathy.
Are people going to call you to complain?
So are they going to get permission to go on town?
It depends on where they're... I have no idea where they're going to be assessing, where the areas are.
They're going to Google Earth it and...
They do a certain assessment of the town, and then they'll identify where to go and look at the potential. And we know where quite a bit of the potential is, just based on the complaints that I've gotten. And just you living here, you know where the mosquitoes are. So
if they're trying to trap mosquitoes, say down on near the Melnick's farm, and they trip and fall and get hurt, are they?
If the Melnicks do not want,
since the town hired them, are we responsible or the Melnicks?
They have insurance. They have insurance as part of the contract, and if they don't want, Melnicks don't want any mosquitoes trapped on the land, then
I'm only
picking
on because she's
sick. I know. They could trip and fall and then just get eaten up by the mosquitoes, right? We'll never see them again.
I just can't be part of it, but that's all right.
Okay.
I'm only one of three. I know,
but that's why I want to bet you, because I'm convinced that you're going to say that this is good information by the end of the year.
I think it's good information for a year to figure out what it is, and since that was the will of the town, let's do this for a year, and then we'll reassess.
Information is inconclusive.
Well, they'll get some information, right?
They're giving us information as soon as they start trapping. And they'll be testing for Triple E and West Nile. And we know we have reservoirs of West Nile already in up by the Cheapside Bridge. So I'm sure some of it will. The point is to have information. Like these concerts on the Common, different events that are happening. If there's something circulating, we can go to people and say, we would advise you not to have this event. We would like to cancel this event. And certainly we can, if it's a town-sponsored event, we can move the time, whatever. We had huge problems when there was stuff, you know, changing the sports events and stuff. But if people have this information, then it's not just Frontier's sports teams. It's, you know, Greenfield and Northampton and Amherst. Everybody's turning up information because we're all up and down the valley working together, and we all agreed on this vendor, and we went through the process of identifying this really good vendor. And the CDC has hired the same vendor to do some mitigation work and handle some of the mosquito stuff in the southeast of the country, and because, you know, Congress is not acting on anything, and so
potentially if the bad mosquitoes are along the Bloody Brook behind Town Hall, then we should cancel Friday night football because it's more dangerous and less Saturday afternoons like they used to.
And school.
If there is Triple E in those mosquitoes, and you're having a football game? Yes. It would be my Board of Health recommendation that we would not have a football game if there was a Triple E effect. One mosquito bite, not only do you have a huge chance of dying, but it's your neurological system is affected, and that child would be affected forever, and that is not worth a football game. But hopefully we get the information and we could eradicate it before football season.
Or we find they don't have any.
Or they don't have it. I mean, that's...
The ones that you caught didn't have them.
The idea is there's going to be enough testing up and down the valley that...
We're not talking about koi dogs. We're not talking about cows. Something that you can see. I mean, in that bottle, you could probably have 2 million mosquitoes in there. And they fly and they go where they want, and the wind takes them. And I just don't see any benefit to them.
Kippy, I'm not on top of the mosquitoes, but these mosquito guys have the answers for you. I'm not kidding. They are so competent.
In the building, they must know mosquitoes.
They do. They're so impressive.
Just let them do their thing for a few years.
I was impressed.
Up what you're going to do.
We'll reevaluate in a few months.
Yes, I feel like this is hugely important, and it's a safety issue.
Okay.
So we are voting the contract with the changes as recommended by our lawyer. I took it home with me. Is there one in the book here?
There is a contract in the book. Unfortunately, it's the original version. Broadly speaking, the amended version as updated by the...
I read it. And I agree fully with it. It changes the years to three.
It limits the years to three. Actually, it's a one-year contract. Any extension of that contract up to three is at the sole discretion of the town.
Yep.
So it's the town's option. It changes the word city to town.
Yes.
In the contract here. And then it adds a number of additional bullet points after bullet point eight, which are standard contract provisions, which are in every contract that we sign. Broadly speaking, the rest of the contract, the services provided, is unchanged.
Yeah.
So you could vote to approve the contract and to sign a final version, to authorize the chair to sign a final version upon approval by Greenfield.
I make a motion that we assign the contract as proposed by with changes as proposed by our legal counsel, and authorize the chair to sign the contract whatever
second
Greenfield does it. Okay, our pricing is based on Greenfield. That's why it's a concern that we have Greenfield be on board, because it was you're doing clusters. It was Greenfield and Deerfield, Northampton and Amherst, Westfield, and West Springfield, and three or four other communities down there. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Aye.
Opposed. Okay. All right. The road reclassification request.
This is, you've got some information in your packet about this. This is a request that comes from the Council of Governments. They are looking to do a number of road reclassifications in a variety of Franklin County towns. The town of Deerfield has three small roads that they're looking to reclassify. They are River Road, south of Route 116, Long Plain Road, south of Route 116, I'm sorry, Sugarloaf Street Extension, south of Route 116, and Pine Street, between Route 116 and Long Plain Road. They are three very, very short roads. In your packet, there's a map which shows the other roads that are part of this reclassification. They include Swamp Road in Whately, the rest of Long Plain Road down to Christian Lane, and the rest of River Road in Whately down to where it meets Christian Lane. By reclassifying these roads, they become eligible for federal funds for repairs and maintenance.
Is there a caveat at all that we have extra maintenance requirements, or we have to mow alongside the roads?
There is no mention of additional maintenance requirements
In
the information that we've received.
Okay.
I don't believe this actually, my conversations with the folks at the COG indicates that this doesn't actually change the town's responsibilities to the road whatsoever. It just makes them eligible for potential federal funding if it becomes available.
All right. I make a motion that we approve the reclassification review.
I'll second the motion.
Any further discussion?
Just one sec. I just wanted to finish.
The letter of support is also included in your packet. That's a draft version. A final version we can have available tomorrow. Literally, we just didn't include the date, and I wanted to make sure that the form was slightly better.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Make that unanimous, Doug.
Mm-hmm.
Draft motions for the special town meeting?
I have updated versions from the ones that are in your packet. These have been approved by town's council. It was very easy to approve them, given the fact that we've seen at least two or three of these motions already. The language hasn't changed whatsoever from the annual town meeting. The names, as to who's reading what motion, that's certainly modifiable and changeable. If any one of you feels you want to read a different motion or don't want to read a motion that's got your name in front of it, I just randomly put in names, so we can make changes there. But there we are.
Okay.
I wanted to make sure you had these. Take a moment to read through. Make sure that they look the way you expect them to. And so long as you're good with them, what I'd like to do is develop a packet for this town meeting like we did for the annual and make that available starting tomorrow afternoon for anybody who wants to come by and pick up the packet. It'll include this information, the draft motions, the narrative in relation to it, and supporting information. It'll include the two contracts for the structured tax agreement and the net metering credit purchase agreement with Lake Street Development Partners. It'll also probably include information in regard to the Tilton Library expansion proposal. And then, of course, the capital project schedule. So there's that.
All right.
I just happened to look at one. When it talks about we get a discount for our net metering credits.
Correct.
What is the discount?
It's about 20%.
About 20%.
Yeah.
Probably can ask.
Yeah. So.
It will change over time. It changes a little bit over time.
The percentage won't change.
No, but it depends on what the cost of electricity.
Right. that there is a risk. There is a bargain bottom basement price that the town will pay, and that's, I believe, 7.5 cents per kilowatt. In order for the town to pay or to receive less than a 20% discount on net metering credits, the price per kilowatt has to drop below 9.6 cents. It's like 9.593 cents per kilowatt hour. Below that, our percentage will drop. We'll be getting less of a discount. If the price of electricity drops below 7.5 cents per kilowatt hour, we will still be required to pay 7.5 cents. We'll actually be upside down. But the last time electricity was at 7.5 cents per kilowatt hour, I think, was during the Carter administration. And the last time it was below 10 cents per hour, it was in 2001. So the likelihood of the town getting less than a 20% discount is extremely low. I actually had to check that to make sure that it made sense.
When we get that, we can apply that toward any electric bills at the town.
Right.
Whether it be this building, the highway garage, the elementary school, or
correct,
the senior center.
Correct. Yeah, and broadly speaking, we will pay about, say, $48,000 a year for $60,000 worth of credit towards electric bills. And even just thinking about our streetlights, because the question was asked, will that ever be more than we need? Just our streetlight budget, our electric bills for streetlights, is about $38,000 per year. So in no way are we going to be anywhere near approaching our actual usage. This will definitely be valuable.
Is this based on this past year's rate?
It fluctuates with the rate. Yep. I believe the terms of the contract state that, it fluctuates with the actual rate. It's an automatic thing. Yeah. Yeah.
One question was, sometimes I see, to move... take from free cash, raise, or some other. So the capital projects would just be coming from free cash.
No, there are actually two sets of capital projects.
I mean, the motion that I'm reading, or
oh, I see.
That I'm on for the Ford dump body tractor, that kind of stuff.
That will be coming from free cash. Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Sounds good.
The other one, the funding source is exclusively
the municipal
building fund.
Okay,
right.
Great.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
I'm
yep.
good with this.
Where's the wastewater stuff? Didn't we have some
wastewater stuff?
Didn't we have any capital for wastewater?
No, we do not. The $130,000 for the headworks design project, that was approved at the annual town meeting because it was considered design and was not required to be part of the capital schedule.
All right. That's one of them.
But there's no capital building or construction.
Now, were we supposed to hear back from those gentlemen I spoke with in your office a few weeks ago?
We are expecting to get more information from them. Tony DeSimone from Weston & Sampson did just get the amendment to the contract, and he's working on getting the generator design put into the overall design of the work that's expected to be done. So that'll be the next step for him, is to be able to present us with at least, I think, 80% completion, mostly complete designs that includes the generator. In terms of what's going on with the sewer rate study, I will need to get an update from Dave on that.
Those two guys seem like they work pretty close together.
Yeah. Yeah. They've been straightforward. They've been honest. They've been very patient so far, as they've been teaching both Kevin and myself the intricacies of what's going on and the various options that are out there. They are very serious about what they do, and they've done projects like this in a number of other municipalities.
The engineer, I think, was the guy that I spoke with about the building size. I kind of took that, I threw him for a loop, and the other guy suggested that they kind of take a step back and see what happens if they come back with the same plans they showed with this big garage and stuff. I mean, how do we as a board deal with that?
I think the best thing to do is for this board to actually appoint that sewer study committee and to get a committee to actually start working on it.
The committee should give us, should review it and then give us a recommendation.
Okay.
And that,
do we
that's
have names for
that?
We have a list of names.
Yeah, we have a list.
We do have a list of names. I wasn't prepared to present you with the that full list, so I don't
by
have it
next,
right here.
By our next meeting?
No, do you think yeah, we next meeting. That? Yeah.
Absolutely, yes.
Do that, okay.
Funny you should mention committee appointments. Did I already give this to you? Yes, you do
yes.
have this. You
yep.
should have a document with a number of appointments in here. This represents an incomplete, it's incomplete, but this does, broadly speaking, give you information about the appointments that the Select Board enjoys. There are a number of boards which we actually had to go back and look into Mass General Law. The oldest laws we were looking at were back around 1905 or 1910 for some of these appointments, and we still didn't get clear sense as to what it was all about. There is a fence viewer. It is still a mandated position, and it has duties that actually seem to supersede those of, it overlaps significantly with the planning board, because it talks about fences and boundary lines and the fence viewer being the arbiter of certain boundaries where a fence is involved, where waterways are involved, various things. What's that?
Do you have one?
Yes, there is. Currently, the current appointed fence viewer is, I believe, Frank Sherburn.
I know Dick Sumorowski and Frank Sherburn were the last ones.
Oh,
yep, I believe Frank still is the fence viewer.
We have a vacancy on the other one.
Yeah. There. Franklin C. Sherman, there you go. There are a number of positions on a number of boards and committees where there are vacancies, and those have been noted. There are a number of positions on a number of boards where if you've got six people with three-year terms, you would expect them to be appointed two per year. There are a number of boards and committees where those staggered appointments were not properly implemented. Mm. There are a number of boards where it mandates five people on the board and there are six or seven people appointed to them.
There some are alternates.
Yeah, but there's no provision in either the bylaw or the makeup of the committee to provide for alternates. There are also are a number of boards where there are people who have been appointed beyond the term limit established by bylaw, and that they can't serve. They can't be reappointed. And all that information is in here. So what I would strongly recommend you do is take this with you, do a read through, and see what you might have in mind in terms of who you might want to reappoint. The names for the individuals are in here. If you need contact information for any of these individuals, we can provide that for you. The description of each of the committees is in here, as well as the terms, number of members, so on and so forth. In all cases where we list terms, that information either comes from the Town of Deerfield bylaws, a town meeting vote to establish any given committee, or from Mass General Law. If we could not find term or number of member information, we did not include it. And so there's that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Can I?
Go ahead.
I didn't get a chance to make a comment at all in my section. So I just, a couple of things was.
I know, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. We've been jumping. It's all right. It's
fine. We're losing it.
So since our last meeting, we got the final letter for the pipeline. I hate to keep bringing up pipeline, but I get asked these questions, so I want to make sure that everybody knows that the pipeline has officially been rescinded.
Withdrawn,
so that's not going to be happening in our area. I did have a person call me and was asking for a lot more information about the pipeline. Interested that it was still coming through, and because it was suspended at that point, but I just want to make everyone aware that it is not going forward at this time. Question?
Yes, we have land that was going to be impacted by the pipeline. We got several letters, and within a week, we got a letter from Eversource saying that they want to do the exact same things that the pipeline was asking, to come in and survey wetlands. So I didn't know if that was a coincidence.
Kathy, they were moving the last rendition before they withdrew. It bumped it on the other side of the transmission lines and the Greenfield side, and they were going to go through the
Greenfield side?
they were going to go through the Greenfield Country Club, and one of the or the golf course there, I meant.
Meadows.
Yeah, the Meadow Golf Course. The reason why they moved the pipeline, my understanding, is Bud Driver has, over the years, has done such a wonderful job of documenting the archaeological finds in Deerfield. And he had gone up and helped the Historic Commission up in Northfield. And apparently there was a gold mine up there of archaeological finds.
My only question was, it was just like a coincidence. We literally got the letter saying.
Yeah, I think it was a coincidence, but.
And then we get the letter from Eversource, yeah. And it's like asking the exact same things. Huh.
Are these high power lines, high tension lines?
That's where it was going to go through our property.
Oh. No, right, but Eversource runs high tension lines through the property, yes?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay, I know that Eversource is replacing all of their towers on all of their long-range transmission lines.
That's on the Greenfield
side. That's everywhere. That's
but
green.
They weren't doing it. They haven't done it that way yet.
Okay. I know that they're replacing them in Greenfield and Montague.
It just seems like a coincidence that within a week we get that letter from Eversource almost asking identically the same thing. So.
Well, they're supposed to, you know, they are aware, especially through your area, they know that there's documented wetlands and, you know, there is burial grounds there and stuff like that. So. Maybe all of a sudden they're aware of it because they usually don't, they just go ahead and do it.
Right, that's what I mean. It just seemed like a coincidence that we get this letter.
Yeah, I think some of this information now is more public, and so they now have to document what they're doing. Because a lot of times they just go through and do it. But I think the level of documentation is such now that they can't ignore ignore what's really there. I don't know. But anyway, we're still, the Municipal Coalition Against the Pipeline is met last night, and then we're having another meeting June 14th. We're still working on the moratorium. We're getting the information that the expert witness that Montague hired is being used by Steve Kulik and Stan Rosenberg, and they're leveraging that and trying to get that sorted out because apparently it revealed quite a bit of solid information that they aren't doing alternative measures that would have allowed them to, you know, not have such a shortage of gas or whatever. So anyway, we're working on that. Letters are being written. Stuff is happening. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. No, it was good to know. Absolutely good to know.
But I did want to make people aware that, you know, all the activity of all the things that were happening in the town of Deerfield really did impact where the pipeline went. Because it was, you know, by Hawks Road originally, then it was, you know, on my side of the transmission lines, and it bumped on the other side, and they just really want to deal with Deerfield. And you know, all this effort really did
it
make
did.
A difference.
Everyone did a lot of work. It's wonderful to see. So so I was just going to mention that about the pipeline. Obviously, that the moratorium stuff is still ongoing. I went out to Worcester today for a municipal finance overview, which was really educational, and Doug and Kat went as well, and I got a lot of information about about tax levies and all kinds of stuff. So it was very good to get a good education out
now
there.
You know
today.
Where how our tax dollars go,
where they come from, where they go, what you can't do, and so it was really educational. The Department of Revenue did a great job, and met a lot of nice people out there. So. That's kind of what my day was like. So that's it.
Thank you very much for going. Municipal finance is very complicated, but once you get sort of an overview, you can sort of figure out what we're talking about, you know, and estimates and stuff, and the way we're conservative, why we keep generating free cash. I mean, that's.
They worked on a lot of that. Talked about free
cash. Yeah, I mean, a lot of our free cash is generated. It is one off, and we just keep doing it.
Correct.
But
we can't continue.
Yeah.
And stabilization funds. They talked about how important those are, and And how much work the assessors do. They just do a tremendous amount of work. So it was good. It's good to get a good overview of all that.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I have a little old business I wanted to bring back up.
Sure.
We had spoken briefly about the sewer rates for town buildings and schools, and I know that you said that it wouldn't be fair to try to impose those fees until the next budget season, but shouldn't we let them all know that this is going to be coming? So maybe we should get a letter
that will be part of the sewer committee would look at that. What kind of usage and then they would recommend to us as the sewer commissioners that we would be charging, and then we would send that off. I mean, we can make that decision, but it should be part of the big picture.
I think the expectation is that there's going to be a presentation directly to this board in regard to several possible ways to assess for sewer costs. And there's going to be two or three different models that you can consider, and the advantages and disadvantages of each will probably be explored pretty clearly. But that's part of what we're paying Dave Prickett to do,
right,
to present options to
us. The budget season really, I mean, I feel like that hopefully the committee will get together and work over the summer so that some of this information will be decided by the fall, which would be in time for the budgets.
Okay. Right.
But, you know, to be fair to the elementary school and Frontier and, you know, and we'll have a...
Starting to set budgets.
Yeah, we'll have a town hall and a town garage and the senior center fees now that we... That
yep.
will all have to be included in the budget.
Okay.
So, yeah, we don't want to lose that, Doug, as part of the budgeting. That will be a new line item.
Honestly, my expectation is that before the end of the year, I'm going to take the last two or three years' worth of water usage for each of those buildings and send a letter to each one saying it's the expectation that the town will or that the sewer department will be issuing you a bill based on previous year's water usage. Here's the bill you could expect to get.
This is something they're going to should be thinking.
Please plan accordingly.
Yeah, I just don't want it. We don't know what it is going to be at this point, but we want to give them a general idea. Whatever the rate structure is, because we're going to have an institutional rate. My understanding is we're going to have different residential rates and stuff like that. So
that's a possibility. That's one possibility. Yeah.
Well, I would say it's a strong possibility. I mean, that's what I would be looking forward to seeing in our rates. Was there anything else?
Mm-hmm. No.
Nope. I'm all
okay.
set.
Doug, did you have anything else in your administrator's report?
I do. I have a number of things. Hopefully they won't take that long. I know we're at 9:00 and it's been a long day for many of us. So I just want to confirm that I will be putting together the special town meeting packet. It'll be available to town residents by 3:00 tomorrow afternoon. So if folks want to stop by town hall 3:00 between 3 and 4 or anytime on Friday or anytime on Monday, they can pick up the packet for the town meeting. Of course, we'll ask that folks only pick up one, not multiples, so that we don't blow our photocopying budget. But it'll be about a 12-page packet, I think, all told. Probably more than that. But anyways. There are another number of projects that are ongoing. We're working, of course, to replace the cable TV equipment in here. That will start probably around June 13. FCAT will be replacing its broadcast server. That'll probably happen sometime around the 16th, 17th, maybe the following week in June, so that by the end of June, we're going to have all new gear in here. The same microphones, the cameras will look probably the same, but hopefully everything else will be slightly better. I've been continuing to work with Don Jacobs on the classification compensation study. I had a preliminary meeting showing some of the results of his research. I'm hoping to get some more information within a week or so and a final report hopefully soon because we need that information as we go into other businesses waiting on that. I will, of course, keep the board informed on that matter. My understanding is that a final draft contract of the cable franchise agreement between the town and Comcast is just about ready. We are waiting for Comcast to finish dotting the T's and crossing the I's and to get us approval on the final draft, in which case we will have a report from the committee here. The contract will be presented. You'll have an opportunity to ask questions, and hopefully we can get that signed. We're over a year overdue for that franchise renewal.
Waitley and Sunderland were with us. Is Conway joining us?
Waitley and Sunderland. Conway will not. Conway's on a too much of a different schedule. They're only about 4 years into their contract. Waitley and Sunderland will be signing the same contract.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
And we negotiated it with that in mind, which gave us a little bit more bargaining power.
So was there any chance, was Conway going to join in at some point? Weren't they trying to negotiate it so that Conway would be somewhat in a line with us at some point?
And that may be very well what happens when Conway's contract is up, that okay. They may ask just to have a contract, like an interim contract, if you will, that matches what Waitley, Sunderland, and Deerfield have done, just to fill out the remainder of the term and to align their... Okay. Renegotiation with
there was some advantage. I can't remember what it was, but there was an advantage for all of us to be together.
Bargaining power.
I know, but
collective bargaining.
I mean, but something else too. There was some technical thing.
Yeah, it has to do with the way the signals are routed and tied into.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that we were doing as much as possible to facilitate us being together.
Okay. King Information System came in last week, to do an analysis and a survey of our paper documents and document storage. They looked at documents and information out in the storage container out back, plus in the administrator's office, plus in the town clerk's office, plus in the vault. They also took a look at some documents and information that's out in cold storage out off the kitchen here. They're going to be presenting us with a report that will provide us with an analysis of what we're storing, how we're storing it, and give us recommendations as to how to better organize it and how to and what documents we can actually dispose of. The analysis was pretty extensive, and hopefully we'll be able to take that data and begin to develop an organizational system using that information. Up to this point, the organization has been lackluster at best. Finding information that's more than 2 or 3 years old is a day-long project, and I'm not exaggerating. If we look for a contract that was signed in 2004, it could take a day to find it. Our expectation is that this will help us to create a system to better organize ourselves.
Are we in the process now, like today's business, scanning that stuff in?
We are.
We can search.
That's the parallel process, and I'll give Kat Dolan her credit for this. She's been working extensively with Laserfish, which is a company that we've worked with in the past. Laserfish was a technology I think that the town bought in 2009. It included a server application, client applications, and some hardware, some desktop document scanners. It was adopted, it was used, there was training, and a couple of people used it for a while, and then it fell off the radar. When Kat and I started looking about 3 months ago for a software that would allow us to scan documents, do OCR, do content recognition, and then do metadata cataloging of documents, we looked here, we looked there, we looked here, and then we found that Laserfish not only can do all of this, but we already own it, and we're two generations behind on our upgrade cycle, but they're going to upgrade us for free. So we're going to take what we already own, get training on how to use it, and then we're going to see if that works for us. The expectation is that if this works, and if this works well, we're going to start doing back scanning of previous documents that exist only in paper form, back minutes, back contracts, correspondence, anything that we need to keep, anything that we can find useful later on, so that if we're looking for tree work,
right,
we'll be able to not only find any contract for tree work, but any set of minutes where tree work was mentioned, or any documentation or records or any town reports where tree work was included, and we'll be able to more comprehensively and hopefully instantly find that information.
I mean, at least going forward, for sure.
Yeah, well, absolutely. Right now, we scan basically everything. Right. We prefer to have information in electronic format.
Yeah.
It's just easier.
Much easier.
So.
Right.
So that's moving forward. At the New Officials Finance Forum today, something that was emphasized again is the necessity of strong fiscal policies. Last week I mentioned that Joe Markarian has given us some information about what's positive or what's possible for fiscal policies. What I'd like to do is actually move forward and work with our accountant to start to flesh that out. I would like to also include some individuals to see, you know, someone from this board, someone from a couple of other committees to start talking about what fiscal policies we could choose to adopt. There are certain basic boilerplate things that are mandated by the DOR that we could just include. We can start with that to give us a starting point. I'm not suggesting that I present these to you and say, here's what you should do, but I'm suggesting that I develop something as a starting point that can then be given over to a committee to review them.
In our community compact, what did we commit to? We committed to reviewing our policies.
Well, we committed to drafting policies. We don't have fiscal policies.
Reviewing anything that we have.
Right.
But that was part of it, reviewing what... Or
developing fiscal policies govern the use of free cash, the use of stabilization funds.
I just wanted to make sure
so forth.
Whatever our commitment is to the community compact, because whatever state money we do get or want to get, we have to be
absolutely.
Our score is going to count.
So absolutely.
We want to make sure that we're meeting our commitment on the community compact.
Yep, and working with Joe is the first step.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
working with him is the first step. I just want to make sure I'm not forgetting anything. I mentioned that. I think that's about it. I was in communication with Kevin a little bit earlier, and he did say that he's very much interested in getting a sewer committee appointed. So I will make sure I forward some names to you along with other recommendations. In terms of these appointments that are in here, do you want us to proactively reach out to the people who are currently appointed and see if they are willing to serve again, or do you want us to wait on that?
We have two more meetings. Why don't you give Trevor and Kip a chance to go through this?
Okay.
And then we can make a decision on our next meeting.
Okay.
We want to make sure that there's what I would like on the agenda for next time would be the 15th, would be we need to do the South County EMS EMTs because we don't want any lapse of... or any question of lapse of for insurance liability.
Yep.
I'm just trying to think if there's... we want to make sure we do the building commissioner and the building inspectors so that there's no lapse. Everything else, I think, can wait till the 28th because we're going to do it on the 28th or have a meeting on the 28th. Just looking at this, I can't...
28th or 29th?
No, the 29th is our, we have meetings already.
We're going to move it to the 20th.
We're going to do it the 28th.
Was that that thing in Greenfield?
Tuesday the 28th.
What's in Greenfield on the 28th?
No, what are the meetings on the 29th?
The 29th would be the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition.
Right. Yes.
And you have the
and
education.
And I have a collaborative meeting.
Greenfield.
That's yes. What okay. Yeah, at the Greenfield Country Club, the one on Country Club Road. What time is your collaborative?
I think it's at, it is at 6.
Oh, it's at 6.
Hampton.
Oh. Well, let me see. We have a meeting on Monday, the MAPCO does, so I will see if we can start at 4:30.
Okay.
And that way you can just go and meet a little bit and
yeah.
have a little bit of food before the 6 o'clock time.
Sure.
Okay.
I'm sorry, was that the 28th that you just mentioned?
Yeah, we were talking about the 28th, having our meeting on the 28th and
our
not...
Our select board meeting.
At 4:30?
No,
this is the, yep. That's the 29th, the
Board of
MAPCO.
Health.
MAPCO.
Okay.
You might want to add the Board of Health agents to this, too. I said Dick Kalaszewski is the building inspector and building commissioner, but also our Board of Health agents. And we should do our Board of Health. We can appoint ourselves Board of Health. Therefore, there's not any liability issues. That would be the only thing I'd be concerned about. Everything else is not a big deal to wait till the 28th. Is that okay, Doug?
Okay. So building commissioners, inspectors, health agents, South County EMS staff for the 15th of June. All others can wait until the June 28th meeting for final appointment.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to try to actually get clarification as to whether or not all town employees have to be reappointed. I don't know if that's done normally or not, but...
I don't think we do that. Although I do remember appointing the highway department. Don't worry.
So let me research and find that out, and I do want to make sure that that's the case.
We already did the police.
Yep.
So there's no lapse in the police.
Yep.
If you think of anything else, put it on the agenda for that 15th that has liability issue potential.
So if it is required that we need to reappoint staff, I'll have that available for the 15th. I'll make sure that's done, because I absolutely positively don't want anybody to not be able to come to work.
No, and we don't also want any liability issues.
Should I find out if there's interest in a meeting with Dan Graves, town moderator, to discuss, honestly, broadly speaking, again, focusing on what we talked about in Worcester today, talking about the financial process, the process of developing a budget, because Dan appoints a finance committee, and he might be
first time too, so.
And he might be the right person to actually talk to about.
Did they have any recommendations for the moderator that was appointing the finance committee at the meeting?
No.
Maybe you can find out if DOR has any recommendations that you could give to Dan.
They didn't have any recommendations to the moderator. There was recommended or traditional roles of any kind of finance or advisory committee in that they come into play only after budget direction is given from the select board through the town administrator to the department heads for the development of the budget. Revenue estimates are gathered. That's one of the finance committee's first roles is they work with the board of assessors and the town accountant to develop revenue estimates. Then there's a joint meeting between the select board and the finance committee and the assessors to talk about those revenues and to actually say, yes, here's what we are going to say. Yes, we've got this money coming in our next fiscal year. By October, department budgets are in. By November through December, the select board conducts hearings to review each of those department budgets. Think about what the finance committee does now. You guys should be doing that.
We do that, but we don't do it early enough. We keep saying we're going to get organized to do it.
And
so this year we're going to say it.
Right.
What did they say, October?
That budget direction goes out to the department heads in August, and budget deadline is October. Public presentations or meetings with department heads, November through December. You finalize your budget sometime in January, and it's given to the finance committee
after that. Make sure you please send a memo. Yeah, send a memo out and say you're sending the memo out because this is a recommendation that you just learned about. Everyone will hopefully comply. We've not had any complying any time like that, but we can try.
Yeah.
We tried really hard this past year.
We tried really hard, and honestly, I think that, only came into the previous year about halfway through, but honestly, this past year, I think, was definitely head and shoulders up in terms of improvement of how it was handled I'm going to attribute a lot of that to Dylan Corpita. His leadership on the Finance Committee was tremendous. It was really exceptional. And his interest in a dispassionate discussion about finances was extremely helpful. And I'll give him credit where I can't give it to myself. There were times where I was very frustrated at you know, at being at a Finance Committee and hearing some of what was being said or whatever. And Dylan held it together. Dylan was far better than me. I hope that trend can continue.
Yeah, well, maybe we can. I know we've tried.
Yeah.
We've tried multiple years.
And reinforcing that point with Dan Graves as the person who appoints the Finance Committee and charges them.
We also have stable department heads now. I mean, you know, we had transition for so many years, so it was very hard to get people together.
Yep.
So we now have, this is Barbara's, you know, multiple times now. This is John's multiple time, and Kevin is even will be his second time, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So
okay,
this will make it will make a difference, hopefully. So if you send it out now, it will be heads up that we're looking for it.
Not quite. Well, I mean, I can send out a quick note to department heads, but yes, I would like to.
I think you need to send out a note to department heads so that there's no question that we are actually going to do it.
Yep, the official request will go out in August.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just a quick question or comment. I think the town is ready, and I think we all are, as far as committees. I think it's time to almost, it may sound crazy, but actually have a local summit with all the players. Get all the departments together before this whole budget thing starts, whether it be in August and that, and let's all sit down as a group, as far as all your committees, and say, okay, this is where we're basically at in the town of Deerfield. Financially, where do we want to head? And make sure that, obviously, people are going to have different opinions, mm-hmm. but it'd be a great discussion to actually spend some time with that whole group. And we might not be able to do it in one meeting. We may need a couple meetings. But at least if we get everybody on the same page of what the town of Deerfield is trying to accomplish, I think it'd make, one, the message would be communicated to everybody. Everybody would be getting the same message. And two, it would give us a clear vision as far as how each and every department should have. I mean, sometimes some departments over here have things going that we're not even aware of. You know, you catch bits and pieces, and Doug tries to update everybody the best he can. But he's shuffling a big deck there. And I just think it would be so much easier if we got people in the same room and actually created, you know, short-term goals and long-term goals for the town of Deerfield. So each department understood their role and how we were going to accomplish that. And it may sound simple.
No, actually, I agree with you 100%. And I also am hoping that Trevor will be able to include our new superintendent. You know, Trevor, I'm sort of tasking him with trying to develop a relationship so we can invite the new superintendent and the principals from the elementary school and Frontier, hopefully, and as be part of the discussion. Because, as you know, it doesn't really matter what we do if we... You know, we need the schools to participate with us.
Right.
And so...
All departments.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
I really do. You know, all the key players and...
But I think that's... that's
know, like the energy committee and the planning boards and so on and so forth. So we all kind of know where we're heading as a town.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I'm not saying we don't have any insight, but I think we're... I think we're a little disconnected as far as our individual groups. Everybody's working very hard, but sometimes we're almost working where we can be a little counterproductive, and that's not a good
thing. We have a group summit sort of thing.
I apologize. I need to be the naysayer here. Broadly speaking, the three of you, and I don't mean to point out the you three individuals, but I mean the three people who sit in this chair as the select board. No matter who they are. Broadly speaking, you agree on a lot of issues and you come to consensus. There are times when you don't. There are times when one person is going to say, you could say what you want, I'm not going to agree with you, and the vote is 2-1. The Finance Committee, broadly speaking, agreed on most issues, but there were many, many votes this past spring, where the vote was not 7-0, it was 6-1 or 5-2. There were a couple that were 4-3, and there were some that failed because the count was the other way. There are larger committees, planning board, the same has happened. ZBA, by law, has to be 4 out of 5, but there have been times when it's been 4 out of 5. If we get into a room, 3 select board members, 7 finance committee members, 7 planning board members, 7 members of the energy committee, 5 members of the ZBA, 3 members of the conservation committee, a superintendent, 7 members of the elementary school committee, the Deerfield representatives to the Frontier Regional Committee, which might be the same people, plus 7 department heads, plus town accountant, plus 3 members of the board of assessors, plus a representative from the police union, plus a representative from the teachers union, plus the department, the rec department head, plus anyone else from the public who decides they want to sit in on this massive, giant public meeting, which is what it will have to be, you will not come to consensus. A cloud sits there with no shape. It doesn't have a direction.
You may not come to consensus, but maybe we could, as a board of selectmen, set a path and take some input.
Now,
I think
you're starting to clarify. Yes. I was going to say, I totally agree with the idea.
I do.
If the people who are there are not employees of the town, but the people who are there agree to not talk about departmental specifics, but rather talk about
the broad
goals of Deerfield.
I agree. We have
Where
to have
do
a
we
tight.
Want our tax rate
we have to,
be? To
have a tight agenda.
Do we want to pursue commercial,
so we don't get down in the weeds.
Right. We can get in the weeds pretty quick, but
yeah.
Right.
But if we could
stay in the air, stay out of the weeds,
well,
and
it can work.
I agree with the idea.
I think what Jeff is talking about is that we can agree on the amount of new growth, the dollar figure. We can agree on the dollar figure generated by, 2.5.
Right.
We can agree on certain things, and this gives us the picture of what the pot is. And this is the pot we all have to work together on. Mm-hmm. And we walk away without saying whose percentage of what is the pot, but understanding that the pot is only so big. And this is what we've been trying to do every year, is show that what we're doing is not really sustainable. Mm-hmm. And we have to figure out how we're going to work together and make changes that are sustainable. But we don't have to do it that night, and we don't have to talk about it, but we need to make all the players aware, because we can't keep doing what we're doing. And there has to be some explanation. And if you don't bring people together, you're giving up. Mm-hmm. And we can't have it piecemeal. We have to be in, this has to be announced. It has to be transparent.
I just believe in the people.
Yeah.
I believe in the people in this town, because I think when you put those people together and you've got, you basically have, this is what we're trying to accomplish. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of good thoughts that can happen and a lot of information that can be shared to help reconnect everybody. Mm-hmm. And in that way, at least in general, everybody kind of has an idea of what's happening and what we're trying to accomplish.
Mm-hmm. And we got to get people thinking about stuff like the OPEB.
Right.
We will know the OPEB number sometime in fiscal year 17.
We had a good conversation on that today.
We already know it.
Well, we will have an official one, because we have to pay to give the official number.
Right.
So then people will need to know, they have to figure out how they're going to finance it under our general, we have to come up with a plan. We have no plan. And I didn't witch about it this whole year. I was very calm, not even funding it $1. But I have to tell you, it's over $1 million, and it really bothers me. You can't keep kicking the can down the road. And we have to come up with some way to deal with that.
We did have a good conversation about that today with
Sean Cronin.
And
the director of DLS.
He highly recommended we get on board with that, and he thought it would be a good idea when we had the finance committee together with Scanlon come in. It was another person, maybe our actuary, to come in and talk about
where we need to go. And he said, you can't do it overnight, but you got to get started. So I know there were questions about it last year, and we kind of kicked that to the side. Even the governor didn't really have an answer. I think we've got answers coming down the road pretty quick, and we got to get on that. So
the problem is, if you do it a proportionate to employees, about a third is the town and two-thirds is the elementary school.
Mm-hmm.
And the elementary school can't ask us for any more money, the municipal squeeze. We can't be squeezed anymore. So the elementary school has got to come up with some way to finance that two-thirds
right.
commitment. And that's where, you know, the pushback came when I was talking about it a couple of years ago is, you know, that's a lot of money.
It is.
To be coming out of the elementary school budget right now.
The even talking about OPEB and talking about, you know, funding for certain things and talking about sustainable budgets, I still feel that that's kind of middle ground. That's kind of in the pattern around the airport, to extend a really bad analogy maybe.
Mm-hmm.
To me, the 30,000-foot height, 30,000-foot goal is where do we want to be? What do we literally... What do we want our tax rate to be? Do we want it to drop? It's a 15.24 or something like that now. Do we want it at $12? That's a question. Do we want the budget to be funded entirely through tax revenues, or are we happy with feeding it with some free cash every year? How much do we want in stabilization? Do we want to fund OPEB? And what is that number, and where does that need to be?
What are you talking about?
Employment benefits.
It's basically health insurance for retired people.
But I agree with both, kind of like a middle ground between the two of you, because I think your idea is right. I think your idea is right, but I think the direction needs to be the chair, the agenda, and everything needs to come to
yes.
these people,
yes.
because ultimately the buck stops there.
Right,
correct.
I know.
And you're the ones that have to sit in front of the town and explain it and everything else. But, I mean, you have to set the agenda. Sure, you mentioned all those boards. You were talking about the heads of those boards. Mm-hmm. You don't need to have every school committee member there. You don't need to have this. You don't need to have that. They're responsible to their committees. They go to represent their committees. I mean, that's the way I would look at it. I mean, that's what you elect them for. That's like when Carolyn goes out, she represents the town of Deerfield because she's the chairman of this committee. She speaks for the committee. With
mostly it's because I'm the only one that wanted to go. Let's face it.
You know, it's the superintendent. The buck stops there. She doesn't need to have... Like Jeff said, the principals, but not every single person on that board. You know, you have to set the tone. You have to decide what your agenda is, what you want to accomplish.
It needs to, you're absolutely correct. It needs to be choreographed in a way that...
Both ways, because that's not going to work.
Right. Spot on.
But it needs to be transparent that the pot, this is the pot. We have to share the pot.
Then you're going back to what Kippy's saying.
I know.
Here's the pot. You can't do that. I agree with what Kippy says about the roof and everything else. You can't say, we only have $2 million. How are we going to spend it? And everybody's going to come in with all their ways of spending the $2 million.
Well, I mean, we can agree on the... Well, what I meant was the budget increase. We try to identify that amount of money every year, and it's just, I mean, that's where we have to end up using free cash, and
I've always told my children this, and my grandchildren, no is not a four-letter word. It is yes. So, I mean, no is not a bad thing to say.
Mm-hmm.
And yes is not a bad thing to say.
But you know what happens at town meeting.
Me, as a resident of this town, the buck stops here. I come, I express my opinion. You can do whatever you want with it, but, you know, we elect the officials and the buck stops to me with you guys. And I'm doing my part as a citizen of this town, and we're concerned where my tax dollar goes by coming here and expressing it to you. And that's the good thing about this country and this government and the way we run our system, but ultimately...
Well, we've been trying to be conservative, and I think it's been working out in the sense that, You know, we have a little break this year and the next year. I think we really were bad. We were in a bad situation a couple of years ago, and we made it through. And it's not quite as
question why.
Oh, we are.
I don't go to all the meetings. I do watch you. It's either being here or watching the Baltimore Orioles.
Well, you know, when the economy crashed in 2008, there's a lag. But one of our main generators is excise tax. Nobody was buying new cars. There was no businesses were leaving. I mean, we have some new growth now. We had no growth for, you know, zero. So the only thing that we were relying on was our tax revenues. And
we're in an industry where our milk check is 40% less than it was a year ago.
I know.
It's horrible.
Know.
So you
it's
deal
horrible.
With that kind of loss in income. You're not telling me anything I don't already know.
I know.
And it's, you know, the market
But people are coming in with budgets that were still increasing. And
right.
So that was where the...
They have no control over some of the things in their budgets.
Yeah.
Right.
I understand that because we don't either.
Right.
But, you know.
And that's why we have there was a little bit of growth. There's, you know, we're generating a little bit of revenue, more of the revenue than we have had in the past. And so we need to sort out sustainable practices now while we have a little bit of
a breathing.
I mean, that we're not talking about laying people off, which is what we were talking about, and we squeezed by. And so we have this budget year, and I think maybe 18 fiscal year.
I mean, loud because you're
I know.
Out there.
No, but we well, I mean, that's part of the process. Right.
I'm part
of the process. But I foresee that the federal government, what happens on the federal government also trickles down. And what was happening, you know, we're the end, we're the bottom. So what the federal government does, it trickles down to the states, and then the states, it trickles down to us. And so when federal dollars dry up, when state dollars dry up, we still are holding the bag, and they still require us to do stuff. And I mean, so when you see some of the stuff, I think that's why I think we're going to squeeze by. This is an election year, so we're going to squeeze by this year, and then we'll see what happens in 18. And you know, we potentially have the year 18 to figure out all these things, because we need to get our ducks in the row and make sure we're okay, because I think it's going to come back after 18. It's going to be some really tough again.
Yeah, but take heed to Kippy's. I like your analogy of, okay, this is what you want, but really, this is what you can afford, or this is what you can get, or you can't get.
Well, and we're going to try to do that. That's what we're doing with the sewer committee, and I think that's why we have to look very much closer to, you know, the library process. If we get in the grant process, then what are we going to do with the building to make it sustainable? And I mean, there's a lot of things that we can be doing better, and that's what we're trying to do, hopefully.
I think maybe the conversation that's being discussed, that's been talked, that we're talking about in terms of long range goals, the 30,000 foot view, that kind of thing, could really be a conversation about, or a public hearing or presentation on those fiscal policies that we've been talking about.
Yep.
Because just in my mind, while you were talking, in my mind, something came into mind. I'm not suggesting this necessarily, but imagine a fiscal policy that says, the town shall strive to reduce costs for maintenance of capital assets. And that's the policy. Now, every department head can take that policy, bring it back to their own budget, and go, how can I do that? The highway department may do that by having a really good mechanic and doing more repairs in-house, therefore reducing the maintenance costs on their capital assets. Maybe the person responsible for buildings institutes a preventative maintenance program that will prevent roofs from failing, but instead will do repairs over time so a roof lasts longer. Or, you know, shovels the roof so the snow isn't on there. Other people, you know, and it can go.
Well,
can
and that's why one of the reasons we.
You know? But even you know, library is looking to expand. How can we reduce our costs, our capital asset management costs? we reduce our capital assets by combining multiple functions into one building.
But one of the reasons, but that's one of the reasons we didn't, we wanted a general like municipal 2% increase max, but we wanted to see what the department heads came up with, because if you had a higher expense, but you in the long run you were going to save dollars, we wanted to make sure that we invested in that person's budget line item that would have made them maybe have a 3% increase.
Sure.
But in the long run, we would have saved a lot of dollars. And that was why we were having flexibility in departments being able to have increases or decreases, whatever.
But as a taxpayer, you look only from year to year. You don't look.
Well, that's why we have a general 2%. We have to, the guideline is not more than a 2% increase. And hopefully, the schools will go along with that kind of thing.
I know they get squished as well.
I know, they get squished.
That sucks maybe over.
No, 8-8 in the bottom of the sixth.
Oh, gosh.
Okay. Good night. Thank you.
Anyway, Jeff, yes, I feel very confident that we're going to move ahead, and maybe we'll be much more successful. Like I said, this is our department heads are much more stable now, and hopefully we can get, because we really wanted this budget process 2 years ago. We were trying to get it in October and November when the last time I was a chair. So
I feel strongly that we have some good people in the proper positions to actually
to make that work.
Yeah,
I agree.
So I'm hopeful. And if Doug sends out the letter that this is the kind of, I know John Petorco always has this by September. So it was a little tough for Kevin this past year. And
this will happen.
Yeah.
We'll make this happen.
Yeah. But I think Kevin has a real handle on it now. And things have settled down.
Yeah,
I mean, let's face it, he's in the highway garage now. He was moving in. He was taking over the budget process. I mean, he was short of people. It was pretty tough for him. And he did an awful lot of work and did a really good job. And, but it would be nice to be able to review the budgets in the fall at a more leisurely place.
Have your own conversations with department heads at a regular meeting. Have your own public hearing on the budget at a regular meeting, and then have a finalized budget that then gets presented for review by finance committee.
I mean, it seems like we do the budget all year round anyway. Mm-hmm. So really for us, starting it in the summer and into the fall is not a big deal, because that's all we do is budget. So.
I wanted to just confirm upcoming meetings really quickly. Next Monday, of course, June 6th, special town meeting.
Yep.
You have a public hearing at 6:30 p.m.
Oh, was that 6:30?
6:30 p.m.
Okay.
That is for the Capitol. I believe it's 6:30.
I thought it was 6.
Check the posting on the way out.
Okay.
I want to say I put it for 6:30.
No, that's fine.
Yeah.
I wrote down on my calendar 6.
Yep.
So
but you have
it
a public hearing prior to the special town meeting. The special town meeting starts at 7 p.m. We do need a quorum of 35 people, so please bring your friends, bring your pets. Your next regular meeting after that is June 15, unless sooner called together upon some special emergency. And we'll include those agenda items, those appointments of staff, essentially. Mm-hmm. June 28th, Tuesday night, we'll have both of these meetings at 6:30, regular time?
Yep.
June 15th and June 28th?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. And we'll have all the other appointments ready to go by June 28th.
And can you post the June 29th meeting as a Board of Health meeting for us at the Greenfield Country Club?
Okay, I'm going to...
Just so that we don't have any open meeting
29,
laws.
2016. It doesn't necessarily have to be, unless you plan to deliberate.
I just don't want to question, that's all.
Fair enough.
I just would rather have it posted.
What time is that, 6 p.m.?
No, I think it's going to be 4:30. I'm going to try to get it at 4:30.
Okay.
Initially we said 5, but I want to see if Trevor can come a little bit.
Yeah, I'll be there.
And that's the MAFCO.
Yeah, it's the Mohawk area.
MAPHCO.
Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition.
Okay. Participation in MAFCO, and that's the annual meeting.
That's something that it's a voluntary type.
What it is, I'm the representative from South County.
Mm-hmm.
I've been chair for years, or co-chair. It's by region, sub-region. And it's It's basically your emergency dispensing site region. So I represent Sunderland and Whately and Conway and Deerfield on the board. It's a voting steering committee. And we have emergency, our funding has actually been cut by 50% over the years that I've been on it. But just like Homeland Security.
You need a better lobbyist.
I know. Homeland Security has been cut about 50% since I've been on too. But, you know, I represent South County, and, you know, so we dispense funding that we get from the state for emergency preparedness for, you know, health issues, health-related issues. I represent Western Mass. I represent 101 communities in Western Mass for Homeland Security on the council. I'm on the oversight committee for Shelburne Control, and that's municipal. That's all the county, towns. Mostly because nobody else wants to do it.
Are we going to an executive session for something?
Yes, please. I would ask for an executive session briefly to for approval of executive session minutes. And I'm actually looking for the other reason.
Why do you want our minutes to be approved, Doug?
For the executive session?
Yeah.
Because they have to be approved in executive session in order for the minutes to remain in executive session?
Oh, okay. I was going to say, if we approve them, then they go public.
If you approve them in public, then the minutes go public.
Okay. All right.
And it's not that, it's not to consider applicants. Ah! I guess to...
Is it a legal outcome?
What's that?
Is it for a legal outcome? Legal outcome is a...
No, it's actually... It has to do with discussing a matter related to a couple of employees, and I'm looking for broad
personnel.
General direction and opinion.
Oh, personnel?
Kind of personnel, yeah. It's related to personnel issues.
Okay. Do you have the wording? I can't remember what the personnel one is. I don't have my notebook that has the list.
Yeah, you know, I'm looking at the open meeting law guide, and this is probably not something to do. Probably something not to do in an executive session, because if it's to discuss a specific individual, that individual has to be invited to participate. So we're going to go into executive session just to approve the minutes.
All right.
There we go.
I make a motion that we go to into executive session to approve our minutes.
Second.
From executive session.
Second.
Okay.
I, McDaniel.
I, Carolyn Ness.
I, Henry Camosa.
And okay. It is 10:15.
And you will come out to sign the warrant to adjourn.
And go adjourn. Home and adjourn.
Okay. Promise to just take a couple minutes.
Do we take these nice...